From Merion Golf Club here in Ardmore, Pennsylvania, it is the U.S. taking on Great Britain and Ireland, the 42nd edition of the Curtis Cup. Wicker baskets synonymous with this great place. Terry Gannon, Paige McKenzie with you. Some of the highlights from the 3-4 ball matches taking place. Rachel Heck, Rachel Keane taking on Hannah Darling, Annabelle Fuller. This at the opening hole from the edge, a chance for Great Britain and Ireland.
And you get a sense of the greens here at Merion. A lot of slope around some of them. Nearly able to grab an early birdie. So
Annabelle Fuller, 20-year-old from England with the miss, and then a chance for Rachel Heck. Birdie to win the hole and a lead for the U.S., which has been dominant through the years. They've won the last two, 10 of the last 12. This at 6. Hannah Darling, lengthy birdie try with authority. So that match is tied. To match two, Amari Avery, Megha Ghani from the U.S., Kayla McGinty, and Lauren Walsh. This Avery for birdie to win the opening hole.
And it played very short this morning, so players able to hit those short wedge shots in close.
Up to the par three, Megha Ghani playing 149 yards today. A little bit of a breeze here, but it's going to be a nice day in the Philly area.
Not a cloud in the sky this morning, and these players able to be aggressive in this four-ball format.
And the U.S. taking a commanding lead in that. Two up in the match. Ghani, this at the 6 for par to tie the hole. They lose the hole, still have the one-up lead in that match. Just getting underway here at Merion today. Match number 3, Roseanne. Millie Migliaccio taking on Louise Duncan, Charlotte Heath. Migliaccio, this at 4 for birdie. And a lead in the match. Zhang was at a spectacular last couple of years. This for par to tie the hole at 5. Not able to make it. So that match is tight. Paige, just a few moments ago, it was the U.S. with a commanding lead. They led in all 3 of the matches, but now 2 of those are tied. Avery and Ghani one up in their match as we get it underway with 4 ball here from Merion. NBC Sports and the United States Golf Association proudly present the 42nd Curtis Cup with uninterrupted coverage presented by Rolex. What a great history to this event. Started back in 1932. This is the 42nd edition. The U.S. 38-3 overall. So they've been dominant through the years, won the last 2, the last one played last year in Wales. Normally every 2 years because of the pandemic, it was canceled in 2020, postponed last year. It goes back on that biennial schedule from this point out. But how about the landscape here? Festivities yesterday, raising the flags, 18 members on each, and veterans as a matter of fact. 5 returning members for the U.S., 6 returning members for Great Britain and Ireland. So they got ready earlier today, a little chilly for the start as they got ready near the clubhouse too. And as they did, they gathered and they sang happy birthday to Rachel Keane, turning 21.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Rachel. Happy birthday to you.
So it all got started with Hannah Darling on that opening tee so close to the patio. Have some breakfast, cup of coffee, and watch the action today. And you at home, thanks for joining us as well. So we got the 4 ball in the morning today and tomorrow. The foursomes in the afternoon. Wraps up on Sunday with the 8 singles matches. 20 points in all. You're going to get 10.5 to win. U.S. holder of the cup has to get 10 to keep this Curtis Cup. So Paige McKenzie and I in the booth, Steve Burkowski as well, Kate Cockrell, Karen Stupples, and Julia Johnson out on the golf course with the matches. Ryan Favre from the USGA in case we have any questions with the rules. Let's take you out to the play here, match number 3. Charlotte Heath, I believe, ready to go. Karen Stupples is out there, twice a member of the Curtis Cup team.
Brings back a lot of memories, Terry, for me to be out here amongst these matches right now. I think on this fifth hole, on the sixth hole, the Americans have a little bit of an advantage. They're in slightly closer to the hole. And this is going to be a really quick putt for Heath back down the hill. She didn't like her approach shot. She gave it the one-handed follow-through. And then it kind of, everybody's like, oh, it all worked out okay. She's been playing very steady of the two players for GB and I. She's been very consistent.
Big break to this putt.
She's about to sit down. It's just so quick.
Yeah, they gave out materials saying that it was stimping at 12 and a half yesterday, which get that little extra roll out at the end.
To the seventh, Steve Bukowski.
Good morning, Terry. Mari Avery getting ready for her second shot. Kay Cockerell with this match.
Yeah, Team GB and I have two balls on the green. This is a short par four. Avery hit that one heavy. Yeah, lucky that that even got to the front of the green.
All right, back to the sixth, Louise Duncan, the 22-year-old from Stirling, Scotland. The lengthy one.
It isn't. And some would think that she has a disadvantage because she doesn't play college golf over here in America, but played at Pine Needles last week and has the big stage at the Women's British Open as well, so a competitor.
Didn't quite make it to the weekend last week at Pine Needles.
Over at seven, Megha Ghane, second out of the rough.
Decent lie from the shady rough. Maybe she'll get some hit and release on this.
Three-year-old from Cary, North Carolina. Star at Wake Forest, Ilya Miliacho now. Chance to win the hole. She's got a putt here in Rose Zank, too.
She does, and Amelia's been playing well. I mean, she's had a few little iffy drives, but when it comes to speed and line on the green, she's been the member of this group here that's actually looked to be have the best chance of making the putt. We saw her make that putt earlier on the par five to win the hole, but and I asked her how much time she's had to get practicing, given that she's been doing so much work for us recently. And she said she was able to practice every afternoon last week.
Look at the break on this putt.
This is huge.
Well, in learning to putt defensively on highly sloping greens that have this kind of speed,
this is
takes
really good.
A lot of practice.
Oh, what a putt.
You can get very exposed if you don't have the experience of doing so, but that tremendous.
Up to the eighth. First match out, Hannah Darling and Annabelle Fuller going up against Rachel Heck and Rachel Keane. Julia Johnson watching this one.
Yeah, Hannah, 120 to this hole location, coming out of the rough, cut only six paces on. It's going to be very difficult to stop this. The wind is also coming out of the left and at her back. She and Anna have been playing a lot from the rough today, so we'll see if they can align it and get it back in the fairway.
And the play here is to allow that ball to cover the front. If you end up past the hole, that's fine. The mistake, however, is to leave it short. Now this might, we're going to have to watch some of these where it nestles up right next to it. There's no real fringe cut, so it can be a little bit tricky.
19-year-old from Irvine, California, Rose Zank with birdie putt to win the hole.
And again, you're seeing that massive break here.
Two pretty good putts, but so tough to judge that. Back up to the eighth.
Annabelle Fuller, the 20-year-old from England, set to go.
Six paces closer, 114 to this hole location. Coming out of the fairway, it should be easier to spin this.
You have massive advantage coming out of the fairway. She'll be disappointed with that effort.
Fuller playing in her third Curtis Cup. Going to be a senior at the University of Florida. We'll keep it here with the Americans, Rachel Heck, Rachel Keane. This match tied for the first seven holes, Julia, and see the great crowds out there. One of the more intimate feelings when you come to a match like this, or they're right on top of you.
They are, and this is such a marquee group with these amazing players, and These fans are excited to be out here and watch them. They've seen some good golf so far this morning. This is headed a little right.
Big mistake
huge,
there,
huge
Paige.
Huge mistake.
Gane for birdie at 7.
Her partner, Amari Avery, has come up well short on her birdie bid. A good 10 feet left for par. Really didn't even give Mega a great read. And that's not in for par. GB&I has 2 birdie putts upcoming.
Another birthday girl, Rachel Keene, 21 years of age today. Pretty big Friday for her.
And she is playing some really good golf so far this morning. She's hit a lot of fairways, very confident off the tee. She has just 88 yards to this whole location today. The wind is picking up a little bit, coming out of the left.
Shocking by the Americans to miss the green with both of those shots with wedges. This stretch of the golf course allows players to score. You've got a lot of wedges into par fours.
Her college teammate at Wake Forest, Lauren Walsh, here at 7, this to win the hole.
Yeah, this are two good opportunities for GB&I. This one just passed the hole. And Paige, as we know, so much of match play is all about momentum, and GB&I finally winning a hole on the last hole, their first of the day, and maybe trying to create some positive momentum.
Yeah, get a little spark, something you can hang your hat on. It's an emotional way to play golf when you do see the momentum shift, and certainly in a four ball situation where you can feed off of each other's good shots and good play, get a little more aggressive with each of your partner's better shots.
Now Kaylee McGinty, this for birdie to tie this match up.
Yeah, this putt slightly downhill, really doesn't have a ton of speed to it, so she can be a little aggressive.
Whoa.
Okay, maybe not that aggressive.
Wow.
These greens at Merion will keep you on your toes.
In a situation like this, Kay, there's not a lot of room on the low side of the hole. So a lot of these players putting from the right side of the green, which would give you that downhill putt towards the left side where the hole location is today.
Yeah, Amari Avery is one of the longest hitters in the game, at least in the amateur and collegiate game, and she in the last couple holes has not really taken advantage of her length and has been a little careless on and around the greens.
Avery for par. Nicely done. You can follow all the action from the 42nd Curtis Cup match, including real-time scoring and the latest video highlights, news, and photos. You can catch it all over at curtiscup.org. Now, McGinty, see if she can roll this in, tie the hole. Oh, my goodness.
Well, that was certainly a surprise. I would have thought one of these two players from GB&I would have made birdie, not be struggling to make par.
Yeah, now it's all on Lauren Walsh. And Paige, you touched on it. I ran into Mark Fulcher, affectionately known as Fooch, yesterday, caddied for Justin Rose here at Merion when he won the U.S. Open in 2013. And he thought holes 7 through 12, the most important, as you said, shorter holes, opportunities to maybe get something that you can put in the bank coming down the stretch.
Most definitely. This is a great match play course because of that. There's a lot of volatility in the early portions because the two par fives are in the first four holes, but then also these next six holes, 7 through 13, give you that opportunity. If you've got good drives and great wedges, you can get a lot of birdies.
Walsh to tie.
So this is how things look right now. The three matches out there playing four ball today. Heck and King, Darlene Fuller tied up. And Gane One up, and the last of the three, tied through six. First of 3 days of play here at a spectacular venue. Merion, we'll talk more about that, but also an event, Paige, with great history. You're part of it. You played the Curtis Cup. How about this time around, this 42nd edition? How do you see things going?
Well, it's almost a rematch of last year's, which this event typically takes place every other year, but because of COVID, postponed to 2021. But you mentioned it, so many returning players. The players on each team very familiar with those that they're going to be playing against today. You know their strengths and you know their weaknesses. But for all the participants, the 16 women out there today, it's an incredible honor to be representing your country and Great Britain and Ireland in this match. It's got an illustrious history, and it's certainly going to create a lot of lifetime memories as well as being great golf competition.
Speaking of history, how about this place, Merion? It's synonymous with the history of the game, in this country. The 19th USGA Championship now being held here. Names like Bobby Jones, Ben Hogan, most recently the US Open with Justin Rose. How about this place?
It's incredible, and I think it's stood the test of time. Over the years, it's had a massive renovation, but it's been described like a vintage car. It's been rebuilt on the engine, but you really have the same charm that has always been apparent at Merion. And I mentioned it and alluded to it. This will be a great test in match play. And one of the ways that Merion has been described to me is a three-act play, a three-act Shakespeare play. The first portion is drama, and we've seen a little bit of that in the momentum shift. The second six holes is comedy, where you do have the opportunity to score. And then the last six holes, a tragedy, because we have seen how difficult those last six holes are, and you just hold on. And even Justin Rose, when he won in 2013, he was 8 over in the last five holes.
That's very deep. I'm going to have to think about that, thinking about this golf course like that. To the seventh.
Luis Duncan, second on the way.
And Berger, she was forced to lay back a little bit because Charlotte Heath has hit it into trouble down the right side. So Duncan not able to take advantage of her length here and just play for safety off the tee.
Well, at least the awareness to understand that your partner in trouble, so let's try maybe go about it a little bit differently. Let's go up to eight, the third for Hannah Darling. Her partner, Fuller, already in with her four, Julia.
Yeah, Annabelle hit a beautiful putt just to a couple inches down here for and conceded her par. Annabelle for birdie.
You know, and a product of that shot is the fact that there really isn't a distinguished amount of fringe around the greens. And so that into that rough is where the ball ended up. And it's something to pay attention to. They actually have red markings on the green as it runs into the fairway and around it in places to help determine where that green ends and where the fairway begins, because it is so fine. And that just very much misjudged out of the rough.
Julia, an update on the Americans and Team Rachel?
Yeah, the momentum has shifted in the past few holes. The Americans had two great shots off the tee in the fairway here and just made bad mistakes with wedges, and then unfortunately got two pretty difficult lies in the bunker. Rachel was on a downslope. Both Rachels were on a downslope. So this, about 25 feet for Rachel Keane's par.
And Fuller taking a one-up lead in that opening match for Great Britain and Ireland. Time now for a message from Mike Wan.
We're the USGA. We're over 100 years old. And while I'm guessing you know our initials, USGA, you probably don't know what we do every day.
All right, I'm a 23.7, so it looks like everyone's going to be giving me some strokes today.
Yep, that's us. By delivering core programs like the USGA Course Rating, Gin App, World Handicap System, we unify players from all backgrounds, ages, genders, and skill levels to come together and enjoy this game. What other sport provides a level playing field to anyone, anywhere, anytime? While this is the kind of stage that most of us are used to playing on, we all dream of playing on golf's grandest stages.
You probably know us for the U.S. Open or the U.S. Women's Open or for our amateur championships. But what you may not know is we conduct 15 national championships every year to showcase the greatest players in the world. And now with the U.S. Adaptive Open, we've added players with disabilities as well. Yeah, you bet. We govern the game too, together with the RNA, so that no matter where you play the game, anywhere in the world, we all play by one common set of rules. Every year we invest tens of millions of dollars to advance this great game into the future through Grow the Game initiatives, turf research to reduce water and nutrient demands, and agronomy experts for our courses. So just keep playing. We'll keep unifying, showcasing, governing, and advancing to make sure golf continues to thrive in the next 100 years.
Back out at the seventh, Roseanne getting ready to play.
With her partner Amelia already on the green, Rose could be aggressive here with this uphill wedge. This is coming in a little low.
I can be thrilled with that one, Paige.
No, it's got a little away from her.
Time now for the marquee match presented by Rolex. Three morning four ball sessions out there, and match one, Rachel Heck, Rachel King going up against Hannah Darling and Annabelle Fuller, and that one's reached the ninth, Terry.
Ninth hole, par three, 174.
Hannah Darling first to go here. This whole location is cut only four paces off the back. This is Sip, headed out to the right.
Long distance there. This part of our marquee match presented by Rolex. So Annabelle Fuller, not just back for a second Curtis Cup, but her third page.
Yeah, and not actually a surprise that this would be the lead match for GB and I. They led off in the afternoon session last year, which was also the first four ball that we saw.
3-2 her record the last time around, last year in Wales, this Curtis Cup. Runner-up, the women's amateur in 2020.
Oh, she's gonna like that shot shape.
Wind.
Ah, but you saw the draw affected by the wind. It was a bit breezy yesterday, but as you can see, affecting the play again today.
So the Americans with a chance here in a moment, as we remind you, uninterrupted coverage of this 42nd Curtis Cup is presented by Rolex. Julie, how about the wind right now?
It's coming a little into us right now. You saw Annabelle's shot, that draw get held up by that wind. Into this hole location, tucked so far back left, it's gonna be very difficult to get something back there. Players are looking to just hit this to the center of the green and give themselves a putt.
Yeah, there's no room behind it, and it becomes very fast if you challenge this hole location. But again, with no flags out there, a little bit maybe more challenging for these players to read the wind. However, she didn't look happy with that.
I've given up on judging reactions these days. Back to eight.
Kaylee McGinty.
Yeah, Avery and Walsh are on the green, but not particularly close. McGinty trying to get this in tight. Oh, a gorgeous
really nice
shot. Really hard hole location right up front.
Golf courses, that short walk between greens and tees. One more to go for the U.S. already in there pretty close.
With Rachel Keene on the green, it opens Rachel Heck up to be able to hit something kind of close and attack this pin, even though this is headed a little right.
Yep, safely on. Heck, part of that Stanford National Championship team. Individual champ 2021. So good chance for the U.S. in that match, up in one of the three matches. Remember, we We've got the foursomes matches later this afternoon as we now take a look at iconic venues presented by Rolex.
It's critical to us to understand that Merion is one of those special places in golf, and there's very few of them in the world. And when you're entrusted with the opportunity to study and focus on the architecture of a masterpiece, it's incumbent on us to do all the research that we can and to truly understand it. It's as emotional a project as I could be involved in. It's my adopted hometown. It's the best golf course in my adopted hometown. It's the place where I learned as much as I can about golf course architecture, and it has the most hallowed history in American golf. I don't anticipate that we'll ever see this again in our lifetime or in our career, and there will always be something truly special about the 6 months that we spent out here trying to make this golf course as great as it can be, or contributing to it, because it was already great.
Venues in the sport. It's about 8 miles northwest of downtown Philadelphia. Golf course been around since 1912. Part of the Cricket Club before that, 1896. So many great moments through the years, and the great names here in that Grand Slam, Bobby Jones and Hogan, the one iron at 18. More memories being made here in the Curtis Cup.
Lauren Walsh on the green at 8.
This is going to be a challenging putt. This is a small green, but tilted from back to front. It'd be fast and moving right to left. Kind of starts flattening out a little bit at around the hole.
Back at 7, Emilia Miliacho, this to win the hole for the Americans.
Well, Chiefy and I still have their work cut out for them to make their pars too.
So does Emilia.
This is what we saw with the last group. Anytime that hole is on the low side of the green, it just becomes very difficult.
Mega Gane at 8.
Yeah, big mistake by Mega, coming up short with just a little sandwich in her hand.
How about this? That's no way to make a birdie. Listen, this is a never give up kind of team for the United States. The two youngest on the team, both rookies this year. And you can see the energy that they can create. Two fierce competitors.
Thank you.
Off a little uphill lie. It does come out kind of low, but all she has to do is carry just the front portion of the green and let it release.
Look at the joy from Avery and Gane. But McGinty still with a chance.
Well, that was an unexpected turn of events, and McGinty had to be mentally prepared to make this putt, either to win the hole or now to half.
I mean, they say be prepared that your opponent can make anything in match play, but I don't know if that was going to be part of the equation. What a turn of events for the United States.
Avery Gane hopping over to that 9-tee, two up. Back to that final match at 7, Charlotte Heath for her par. American's still not done, Karen.
No, played a great shot from the bunker.
Quick moment to let you know some of the greats have played and they've won. History has been made. It's one of the toughest tests the golfers face all year long. The 122nd U.S. Open from the Country Club in Brookline, Massachusetts gets going next Thursday on NBC USA and streaming on Peacock. Miliacho, this to tie the hole at 7. Gets it to go.
Rose is smiling.
Great Britain, Ireland 4, United States of America 4. The match remains tied.
That one remains tied as we head up to 9.
Rachel Heck, lengthy birdie try.
45 feet here for her birdie. Hannah Darling just hit her birdie putt about 10 feet by the hole.
Keane still has a run at it for birdie for the U.S. Mitchell Heck, the 20-year-old from Memphis, part of that Stanford National Championship team. And see at the bottom, the 2021 NCAA individual champ.
She went on quite the run that spring season as a freshman, winning conference, regionals, and NCAA championship.
Yeah, all she did was win six times in that spring semester a year ago.
And a total of eight times, yeah. Annabelle Fuller, Great Britain and Ireland now.
Just shy of 45 feet here for her birdie, working back up the hill. Unfortunate that Hannah couldn't put something a little bit closer so Annabelle could give this a better run. It's still a good look, though, working back up this hill. Just has to be conscious of the speed.
As you said, so that gets away from it a little bit, too. Mentioned his name a moment ago. The win here, 2013, the U.S. Open. Justin Rose, Olympic champ. Wishing the GB and I Curtis Cup team the very best this week. Here at Merion. So Keane's got a putt for birdie to win the hole. Heck might putt first for par. Ryan Farber, bring him in from the USGA and the options here for teams.
Yeah, thanks, Terry. So in four ball, the order of play is really based on the side. So as long as one member of the side is away, they can play in any order they want between the two partners.
Go ahead and make this. No. Wanted to take some pressure off.
Well, and in this instance, you might have gotten a tiny bit of the end of the putt read as well, in addition to holding that par putt and giving Rachel an opportunity to give it a run.
So this for birdie to win the hole.
Yeah, I like that.
Might be enough.
Yeah, exactly. GB and I not in yet. Well, whether it's the rules, handicapping, conducting 15 national championships, or bringing new people to the game, the USGA is focused on the good of the game for the next 100 years and beyond. Visit usga.org/about- to learn more. There's an us in there somewhere, too, I think.
Yeah, USGA.org. Yeah,
a lot going on there. Exactly. Hannah Darling, first of the two par putts, opportunities at least.
Two looks here for par to tie this hole. You really don't want to give one back after winning the last hole. Hit this a little long. The speed has been a little off for this group on this hole. 10 feet here for her par.
It was just low the whole way.
So one more chance for Fuller to tie.
She got a good look from both Rachels. She's on a slightly different line, but they both missed their putts high. And she got to see that, so she should have an idea of what this might do. Just 5 feet for her par.
And that's just really important in the match to kind of maintain any of that momentum that they just gained. I mean, they were down early, got it back. Plus the confidence of making this length putt also. Well done.
Yes. Great Britain and Ireland 3. United States of America 3. Great Britain and Ireland remains 1-up.
Fairly big to hang in there.
Absolutely.
You know, the U.S. with a good chance.
Given where Rachel Keane was off that tee ball, clear advantage to the United States team. So the fact that they walk away with a very solid par and have after getting up in this match.
Yep. All right, so next match back there on the tee, the U.S. and Mega Gane first to go.
And I would say that Mega has a flair for the dramatics. We saw a lot of that last year when she would finish low am at the U.S. Women's Open. And she loves the big stage. Trying to hit this shot 160 yards to ensure carrying the bunker. And push that out to the right. She's been missing a few shots to the right.
Get a little help coming back. I wouldn't mind that for a leadoff hitter in a four ball group.
Seen that putt too.
Yes.
You're going to see it some more. Mega Gane, 18 years of age, from New Jersey, incoming freshman at Stanford. Not a bad place. Come off that national championship. And one of the rookies here, one of three rookies in terms of the Curtis Cup. Avery Knott.
This Team USA of Gane and Avery are familiar playing with each other. They played together in the Solheim, the junior Solheim last year, and paired up winning a match together. So a confident winning team, they have that in their memory banks, and I'm sure that went into in the captain's mind of pairing them together.
Stanford versus USC as well.
Interesting point you make though, Kay. So many team junior events now that by the time they get to Curtis Cup, which is the pinnacle of team amateur golf, they do often have experience with each other in other team events.
Yeah, Junior Ryder Cup, Palmer Cup, and of course the Europeans and GB&I play a lot of international team play. Wind picking up a little bit, slightly hurting left to right, making this a really hard hole location to get at.
All right, well, they try to decide. Annabelle Fuller here on the tee at 10.
Going with a three wood here, taking it over the right side of this bunker, 200 yard carry, looks really good.
It's another one of those par fours that can be very much a scoring hole, so putting yourself in position, priority number one.
Walsh on the way at 9.
Yeah, I think she went back for a little more club, but really missing this poorly to the right. Shocking miss there.
That deep rough too. Ball disappears. Up to 10 again. The tee, Hannah Darling trying to pick a line.
It's 197 over that fairway bunker, but then you have the additional carry over the rough. Certainly players could hit drive if they wanted to, but narrow depth-wise on the fairway along that line. So most of the players choosing to kind of cozy up the left side of the fairway. It's 240 through on that line. Mistake.
Not quite, yep. Didn't quite get there. Kim McGinty last play here on the tee at 9.
A lot of pressure on Kayla McGinty to find the putting surface with her partner in the bunker. And that's a good, solid, safe shot and much needed by GB&I.
Absolutely. Rachel Keene on the tee at 10.
Also going with a 3-wood here. She's been very accurate with this club today. And this is headed right up the center.
That's all you're trying to do on that shot.
By the way, they roll the fairways here.
How good does that sound to hit off of?
They are just pure. Back to 8.
Rose Zhang, last to play.
She is after hitting the longest drive. Louise Duncan already on the green with a really good look at birdie, so pressure is on her to hit a good one. I'd say this is pretty good.
Yeah, ooh, really good.
Pretty straight putt coming back up the hill.
Driver for Rachel Heck at 10.
Yeah, she's done this already today. Rachel Keene's put it in the fairway, and Heck then takes a driver and rips it down there.
Did not hold back.
They're looking at it.
Yeah.
It'll be an okay angle into this green, however. No, it's just out of the rough.
It's So about an hour ago, it was all red on the board. But right now, Darling Fuller with a one-up lead, two up, Avery Ngane. And the last match out there is all tied. Well, not playing this morning, certainly expected to be one of the stars for the U.S. Jensen Castle. Take you back to the 2021 U.S. Women's Amateur. Had a fight, really, to get there. Won a 12-2 playoff. Just kept making putts and great shots. And the win, and a smile on her face right now as she looks at that trophy being hoisted. Jensen Castle joins us here in the booth. That nice image right there. That's pretty good, right?
Yeah, that was really nice.
Hey, this is your second time back at the Curtis Cup, and it's back-to-back years. You played last year, pandemic the year before. How much does it feel like a bit of a rematch?
It's definitely a rematch with so many of the girls being back on the team. I think there's a total of four new players on both sides. Well, two on U.S., and I think that's... No, it's three on U.S. and two on Great Britain and Ireland, so it's very similar as in Wales.
How different is it playing at home, though, on home territory?
It is very different. Everyone wants to cheer for us. In Wales, it was not like that.
Thought on Merion, this place? I mean, so much history here. How about the actual golf course? Spectacular, isn't it?
Golf course is amazing. Rough is thick. Great match play golf course with the three style with drama, comedy, and tragedy. I think that is amazing because you're never out of it with the last six holes being tragedy. Anything can happen. That's important in a match play.
Going to stick around, call a little golf. Emilia Migliaccio, pretty good putt there, right?
Talk about being above the hole and how challenging it can be with the speed of these greens.
Yes, it's very challenging on some putts. They're quicker than others. And I'm a pretty firm putter, so I've seen the nice 8-footers, 9-footers coming back. It's not shocking for sure. But it really tests your ability to have really good speed out here.
Now, Charlotte Heath here at 8.
One of the awkward things here, the collar is so long, so you really do have to pay attention to how close you are to it and what kind of shot you want to play from it.
Interesting play there, Paige.
Little Texas wedge.
How'd you like that?
That was very interesting. I think it's very difficult once you get up close to the rough because it's hard to putt with your putter getting stuck in the rough on the way down, but that almost looked like a putt.
That blade is able to cut through. If you do catch a little bit of that thicker rough, it's able to slice through, certainly a lot easier than the putter face. I think that the touchy-feelies around the greens with this thick rough can be really challenging. We saw Hannah Darling try to putt out of the rough not so successfully earlier in the day. But how much time did you spend in preparation for this week trying to hit these little pitch shots around this kind of, it's different texture grass?
Definitely. I came from the open where there wasn't that much rough. So we come here and, you know, you got to chop it out.
Now, Louise Duncan here at 8 for birdie.
I think this is the key to this putt is a patient putt. You've got to patiently wait for it to take the break and drop in the hole. Can't force it. So Roseanne will have a chance to win the hole.
Yep, par conceded to Duncan. We'll wait on Rose here on 8. Jump up to 10.
And continue to spend time with Jensen Castle, Kentucky Wildcat, Fuller, Florida Gator, right? So some history there as well in college. And you've got South Carolina product and Hannah Darling also out there. Those rivalries continue on this stage.
Yes, big SEC.
Julie Johnson out there, national champ at Ole Miss as well.
Hottie toddy from over here. Hannah with just 84 to this hole location. Cut just 5 paces over the bunker. Very difficult on this left side because you have to clear this bunker.
Go.
And that's well done.
Yeah. That's about as good as she was going to do from that angle.
Back to the 8th.
Rose Zhang's got this. Put the Americans one up.
Pretty straightforward, as Paige was saying. You got to give this one some good speed. Let it hit the back of the hole.
Oh.
Ooh, that moved a little bit.
Bit of a gift there, Paige.
Yeah.
Keen on the way at 10.
Just 1 yard closer, 83 to this hole location.
Move that one back, but both with good looks there at 10. Excellent approach shots here. every team has a different personality, Jensen. And I know we talked about just being a year ago, but how about this team as opposed to last year's team? And what do you expect through the week?
It's very similar with a lot of the same players, and most of the same players have a really big personality. So you're seeing the still a loud, confident, big personality team.
Was it like just an extension of last year when you got back together on the golf course here?
Definitely. For me, last year it was a little bit tougher just because it was such a quick turnaround from the AM, as well as there was a few of us that didn't get to spend the first 3 days with everyone. So we had a harder time like catching the vibe, per se. But this year, you know, we all had the practice session, and we also had the full week together.
Yep. You can see the golf ball at least here.
She has a pretty good lie out of this rough. A good angle, too, with a lot of green to work with.
Looks like she's playing for a little bit of release. You see that abbreviated finish, allowing for release out of that rough. That's tremendous.
Back at the ninth, Megagane for birdie to win the hole, Kay.
Yeah, trying to win two holes in a row for Team USA. Uphill putt, not much break.
I feel like we have a good read on that because we've been watching that putt over and over again already, but they haven't.
No, but good judge of speed there. Now, Jensen, we're looking at these pairings and partnerships. How much of the past experience kind of helped contribute to what maybe we're seeing with players matched up today?
I think it's been very important, especially for both coaches to be the same coaches this year. You know, they've seen who goes well together and the games are similar. And this year we had a practice session unlike last year. So, you know, they know who plays the similar games. Like, for example, my partner today, she and I play a similar game for alternate shots. So it'll be a good fit.
So you prepare right after that. You're going to go out and watch. What are you going to do?
So I was just out watching this morning. I'm probably going to go get some lunch, and then I'm going to go grind for the alternate shot in the afternoon.
All right. Good luck with that.
Thank you.
Appreciate you coming in. Jensen Castle here. Nice to spend some time. Be out there this afternoon. We've got the foursome matches this afternoon. Four ball continues this morning here at Merion. One up lead in the opening match for GB&I, and the Americans just had a chance to go three up, but two up in the match, the other one tied. Some of the stars, the young amateur stars here. Women's team event, normally held every 2 years. Second time here at Merion. Rose Zhang ready on the tee.
Really tough hole location, this one. Down there on the back with the wind off the left a little bit. The Great Britain Island team are not in particularly close. Louise Duncan is just on the very far right side of the green.
White. Check on the lie when they get up there. Moment to remind you, uninterrupted coverage of the USGA Championships is presented by Rolex. Emilia Miliacho now, after seeing Zhang go in the bunker.
Well, and this changes your strategy again, too. If your partner's hit it into trouble, you cannot be all that aggressive. You have to give yourself a chance at a putt here. I mean, it is a tough hole location. I don't think you should be looking at that. I think a line along the line of our TV tower in the background, kind of maybe use the contours of the green to help get it towards the hole. But so much of match play is the strategy, particularly in the four balls. Who tees off first? Who's going to be the consistent one hitting the green? Who's a naturally more aggressive player? Because they're the ones that should be going last. That's a good strike, and just what she needed to do.
We've seen a lot of players end up on that side with that left to right kind of crossing wind. Not a surprise with the left hole location.
Emilia Miliacho, who we've gotten to know very well the last couple of years. It's amazing. I mean, she's 23 years old. We've got teenagers here, but we get to know them at a very young age.
Certainly, and of course with Emilia, she's worked with Golf Channel a little bit over the last couple months, so certainly been able to do that as well.
Hex putt's been given here, this for birdie to tie the hole.
Downhill, moving a little bit.
Oh. Yes. Come on!
How about those last two putts from Fuller? Tremendous to keep the momentum on the side of GB and I, keeping that one up lead.
Really important putts the last two, so they remain one up. They head to the 11th par four. Meanwhile, match two has been waiting for a while. Kay?
Yes, mostly waiting out of etiquette for the nice large galleries that were short of the green. And, you know, this is a par four that if you want to take driver and challenge it, you can get pretty close to the front of the green.
Yeah. See that grass in the bunker. Gilhan took a lot of that out. There was much more of that before the reconstruction.
You can see how sharp that fairway turns.
Kane ready with a driver.
Yeah, 266 to the front, which it's out of reach, but if she wants to go ahead and hit it up there, try to get as close as she can. And that's a good-looking drive right there. And that's a tough little hole location. Paige snuggled up to the front left part of the green, but she has plenty of green to work with.
Well, I think you're just seeing some serious youth confidence right now, too. I mean, it's not about just finding the fairway, which, frankly, Kay, I would be happy with finding the fairway given that hole location.
Yes. Well, Avery's got massive power. Be interesting if she can really let this rip, which that looked like a great swing. And just flies over Gane, but into that rough.
Got plenty of green to allow that to release, but also tremendous amount of power in Amari Avery. Joined USC in the middle of the season this year just as a freshman, but immediately made an impact. And you can see what a gorgeous golf swing and tremendous lower body movement through impact to get a lot of that power.
Three wins, All-American year. Ginty next.
Kaylee goes after it pretty hard as well. Just doesn't have that same carry that Amari has. I mean, it's such a weapon to be able to carry it that far, and particularly on a difficult course like this.
Well, and in four ball.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Got a partner, put it out there and give yourself a green light.
Lauren Walsh, driver as well.
She tends to hit a lower tee ball with some penetration, and that is not going to be a good leave in that left rough.
Well, Jensen Castle mentioned it, the U.S. Women's Open a week ago at Pine Needles, and Minji Lee. How about the performance she put on through the first 3 days, and then started with a birdie at one, the final round, and then this at the second hole.
She made a statement pretty early on. Almost nobody made birdie from that position throughout that Sunday.
Just so impressive. Kind of ran away from the field. Win by four of Mina Haragai, 13 under, setting records along the way. Second major title. She was number four in the world at that point. Karen, looking in the bunker here. What's going on?
Well, referees has been called in just to make the decision. Rosang had to go stand by her ball in the bunker so that he could see who was away. And it's actually going to be Louise Duncan who have a putt first. Charlotte Heath was all the way at the very front of the green and has putted up past the hole. She hasn't been able to mark her ball. She's just off the green surface. And this putt here for Duncan, it's not easy. There's a good little bit of left movement to it, but it's uphill to the hole. And the extra pressure too, Paige, and I mean, the partner isn't in particularly close for her par.
No, the last thing, I mean, it's so difficult to think speed. You feel speed, but so oftentimes when you know the pressure's on you as a partner, you kind of fall into that trap.
I've got to say, having played here yesterday, I found the uphill putts more difficult to judge the speed on than the downhill ones. That was good for speed.
Very nice.
Do we have a number on that round yesterday?
I can tell you what I was for the front nine, but the back nine we're not talking about.
That's where the tragedy happened.
Oh, it was too.
is Duncan, 22 years of age, from Scotland, Stirling University. You get the world amateur rank, so it includes, the field includes, Rose Zeng, who's number one. But her second appearance, played last year in Wales, Louise did. Zeng from the bunker now.
Really firm sand in these bunkers, and I think that some of the best bunker players in the world will tell you that they love firm sand. You feel like you can really give the ball a good thump when you're coming through it. She has plenty of green to use, and with her talents, I expect this to be a good shot.
I would add very to that. Deep bunker, just seeing where it ended up now.
Yeah, it's still a little bit of work left on that one, but Charlotte Heath will give her a decent look at the line from her putt. But in the meantime, Amelia's got a chance to win the hole, so it may not matter. This is that uphill putt, and she knows it's going to break quite a bit too, having watched Louise Duncan's ball do just that.
She is going back to Wake Forest, so we will see what kind of student she is.
Huh. I'd say she's a pretty good one. You know, given the work that she does with us, Paige, and when we see her in our compound working away at her notes and stuff, she definitely takes it all very seriously. Okay. Well, maybe that's just outside the comfort zone.
Up to 11, the par 4, opening match, getting ready to hit their second shots. We'll watch Annabelle Fuller.
Annabelle and Rachel Heck, the only two to hit the fairway here. Their partners are both in the rough, Rachel Keane on the right side, Hannah Darling on the left. So important to be in the fairway on this hole with such a small green, hole location cut only 8 paces on. Very difficult to hold this green, especially with the wind down right now. Straight at their backs. Annabelle has 109 yards, 101 to cover the front edge.
Visually may be intimidating, but with this yardage, it should be a green light.
Shot.
Okay.
Good smart one there by Annabelle Fuller. Rachel Heck, fourth in the world amateur golf ranking. Her partner, Rachel Keane, 11th. Hannah Darling, 14th. Annabelle Fuller, 44th. The very best in the women's amateur game on display, taking center stage here this week at Merion.
Rachel has really found her game recently. She's been hitting a lot better shots than she started the round with. She just has 108 to this whole location.
Another good one.
Par putt, Rose here at 9.
Heath has already missed her par putt.
Everyone's missed it on that side.
And she's missed a couple that were makeable for U.S. so far today.
Now Hannah Darling at 11, and as you said, Julia from the rough.
And she's a little buried over here. A better angle on this left side to this whole location, but her ball settled down a little bit. She just has 97 yards, but it's imperative to get it out of here and get it on the green away from that water.
So clean through the grass. Well done.
Louise Duncan on the way for par. There you go. Biancho still with a par putt to tie for the U.S.
Rachel Keane at 11.
1 yard closer than Hannah Darling, 96 to this whole location. She has a lie that's been battened down by the cart, so able to get something on it for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Who would have thought the two from the rough ended up better than the two from the fairway? Take a look at some social media. You think it's a good week for Wake Forest women's golf? This will never get old. Ready for a great week watching these competitors, Amelia Migliaccio, Lauren Walsh, Rachel Keene, Demon Deacons, well represented here this week.
Speaking of Amelia, Wake Forest, this at the ninth for part of time. Yeah. Almost a gimme.
Almost. We can't take anything for granted.
That match tied. On the way here at 10.
Yeah, that was a lob wedge from 67 yards. Really nice shot. And reaching a little bit past the hole.
Mari Avery.
Yeah, just a really good look. Oh, wow. That was a shocker.
Well, and that's part of the difference between fairway and rough, just being able to control your ball.
Well, we had a visit with Jensen Castle for the U.S., and now one of the players for Great Britain and Ireland, Emily Price, joins us, 22-year-old from England. I'm going to look over here and if I can see you. What's this experience like? There's so many veterans here in the Curtis Cup. It's your first trip. What's it been like so far?
Unbelievable, to say the least. I didn't really know what to expect. You expect great things, you know, to have a great week. I've known most of these girls since I've been 6, 7, 8 years old. So to be here this week on a golf course that looks like this is absolutely incredible. It's been a great week so far. We've been here, done some tourist things, played some different golf courses, spent 4 days on Merion so far, and I'm nowhere near bored. I don't think I could get bored out here. So yeah, we're having a great time.
Well, speaking of Merion, then you would know, what are the keys? What are the keys that you have implemented in your game plan as you approach this golf course?
Hit the fairway and stay short of some of these pins. The rough is so brutal out here. You don't know what lie you're gonna get. I think I heard there's 7 different types of grass in the rough here, so it can get nestled down pretty easily, and with us going in with some longer irons, not able to control it that well. So if you hit the fairway and you stay below some of these pins on these slopey greens, you should be in pretty good shape. That's really all it is.
What are some of the tourist things? You mentioned you've done some tourist things here in Philly.
Yeah, we went into Philly, saw the Rocky Steps, Declaration of Independence. Just this, you know, we travel a lot, and not often you get to go out and be a tourist and explore where you're staying. So to also do that on top of this experience really has topped it off.
Did
for
you
us.
Do the Rocky pose?
Oh yeah, we did, for sure.
You took a picture. Yeah, you have to. I might do that later this week. We'll go in and do that.
Like it.
In Philly. All right, Annabelle Fuller, talk about your teammates here. I know on social media I saw a couple days ago different teammates, and this one's the funniest, this one's the team mom. How about Annabelle?
She is the team mom.
Okay, that's team mom. Yeah.
We actually wait for Annabelle to send us a text in the evening with our uniforms for the next day. She has a good eye for that, you know, to look good on the camera. So we trust her with that. And I mean, I've played with Annabelle since I've been, like I said, 7, 8 years old with the U.S. kids stuff. And, you know, she's just a great player all around. Ball striker, putting, short game. She's a really good person to be around. A lot of fun.
What about the partnership here with Hannah Darling? These two partnered up also in the four balls first day last year. What do they each bring to the table?
They've got a pretty good connection and they work really well together. I think Hannah hits it a very long way. And then Annabelle also has the short game side of things. So they pair up pretty well. They're really good friends. And I think, you know, having someone out there with you who makes you feel comfortable and can relax you and knows you as a person really, really does help when you're out there on the golf course in these conditions under these sorts of pressures.
So we saw Fuller lag it down there nicely. That one got away from Rachel Heck. Julia?
It was a great putt by Annabelle Fuller to get it down there, get it conceded. Gives Hannah the ability to give this one a run. You saw Heck putting this about 6 feet by. Now Rachel Keene has to be conscious of her speed. Hannah Darling with just 15 feet for her birdie putt, straight down the hill. Should work right to left on her.
Mm-hmm.
I think she expected that one to move left, and a common refrain, 3 or 4 feet remaining for Darling. Now, Julia, you've been out there this morning watching this opening match. Emily Price will go out this afternoon. Do you want to maybe give her a few things you've seen from Merion today that could serve her well later today?
She seems like she has a grasp on it. Don't hit it in the rough. I mean, the rough is just, it's brutal out here. Unless you have a wedge out of it, it's pretty difficult. A lot of these players have been hitting their putts a little long. So be conscious of the speed, rolling a 12 on the stint meter, I believe. So just a few tips, Emily.
That was heck.
Solid.
Drop back to 10.
Megagane for birdie to win the hole.
Yeah, by far the best approach shot in. Speedy putt, although it's short.
Rachel Keene at 11 to tie this matchup.
7 feet left to right.
Yeah. Woo-hoo! Go!
Great Britain, Ireland 4, United States of America 3. Matches tied.
Good shot, Rachel.
Wake Forest teammate Lauren Walsh, this here at 10. Part of tie.
Yeah, this downhill putt. She's been grinding and making some good par putts. Yeah, USA is not yet in the hole for par. That short putt up coming for Megagane, not conceded, and Amari Avery basically ball in pocket.
Emily, you have a strategy on conceding putts? Give one early, don't?
It really depends how it's, you know, how you're sitting, how you're feeling. I typically, depending on, yeah, what the putt is, how, you know, the slopes on the greens, these greens actually around the hole can have subtle slopes and little breaks at the end where it dies off a different way to you think. So giving them is probably going to be a little tough out here, you know.
So the U.S. stays two up in that match. Any secrets you want to give out about the GB19 before we let you go?
Any
because
secrets?
You've been been really insightful about them. And
yeah, no, we keep us. If I give a secret, they're going to give one about me. So I got to be careful what I say.
Smart. Very smart player. Emily, thanks for coming
you.
In joining us.
Perfect.
Been fun.
Thank you.
Good luck
this
afternoon.
Thanks.
All right, Emily Price, 22-year-old from England. Check the leaderboard again. So that opening match, all tied now. Darling and Fuller, Heck and Keene, two up in that second match and tied in the third. So we take out to the 12th.
Yeah, with that opening match, Rachel Keene on the tee with driver.
Walking off that green, she told her caddy, I just wanted to get the tee back. So she's excited to be teeing off here. This is headed right, though.
You can see a little bit of the golf ball there, Paige.
You can, but I mean, that's what I was hearing from Emily Price is what I've heard around from a lot of the players and people that know Merion, which is, it's hard to know what the ball's going to do once it's in there. So important and paramount to be finding these fairways.
Rachel Heck next to play, also a driver.
The line here is just the right side of this right fairway bunker. You really can't go through on that line, and it gives you a good angle into this green.
It's a little uncomfortable of a shot shape if you're not comfortable hitting the fade, but no problem there for Rachel Heck.
Quickly down. After that tee, good one there by Heck. Time now for the marquee match presented by Rolex. And it is that opening match. Rachel Heck, Rachel Keene from the U.S. going up against Hannah Darling and Annabelle Fuller from Great Britain and Ireland. That match tied through the first 11. The marquee match presented by Rolex. Now Fuller.
And she's missed a lot of drivers right today. This one back online.
This whole fairway slopes. You can kind of see it as you're sitting on the tee.
Again, that opening match, the marquee match, presented by Rolex.
See, see that fairway sloping back into you, as I was saying. So those approach shots, you're going to have the ball a little bit below the feet on this uphill approach into the green. So always cognizant of kind of working the hole backwards, where you want to play from.
Look at Darlene, her heels.
Trying to get every inch of the angle.
With her firepower, Paige, you thought maybe in a more of aggressive line considering that Fuller's in the fairway.
Well, and the further you play towards the trouble, the better angle you're going to have.
Rose Zhang set to play her second at 10.
Amelia's already hit the green, but it's a little bit past. And Rose Zhang is not firing on all cylinders today.
Yeah, we've seen her miss the last couple of greens, miss a couple putts.
So an opening for Great Britain and Ireland. There you see that opening approach shot for the Americans, Miliacho.
And I really like what's happened here with the British players. They've taken their drivers down here a little bit deeper, allowing for a slightly better angle to this really difficult to get to hole location, tucked in that back left corner. And even though Duncan is in the rough, she's got a good lie. And I think she's going to be quite comfortable with maybe landing this short and letting this hop back and chase on towards the flag.
We got a chance to see the world rank of this pair. One ranked number one is Rose Zhang, and then 19th in the world, Emilia Miliacho. Both ranked higher than Louise Duncan and Charlotte Heath. So the on paper favored the U.S., but nothing ever happens on paper, does it, Karen?
No, and when you think about Louise Duncan, she's somewhat of an unknown, doesn't play college golf over here. But she got herself in a position to win the AIG Women's Open at Carnoustie.
Played the U.S. Open last week at Pine Needles. Didn't quite get the run out she was expecting there. We've seen that as a very popular style shot from the rough on that right side, just kind of allowing the release into that hole location.
Now, of the two GB&I players, I think Charlotte Heath plays her golf at Florida State University. So this is going to be a more comfortable sort of shot for her to kind of just try and fly this one in here, get it that one check and stop.
No, two hops and a stop, but got there, stopped on the surface. Well, it's time now for Signature Moments presented by Rolex. Take you back to the 1994 Curtis Cup held at the Honors Course, Chattanooga, Tennessee, where on the 15th hole, Joe McGill holed a birdie putt to win her match 4-3. And Katrina Matthew with the long birdie putt on 16 and good. Eventually, matches would end up tied at 9. Great Britain and Ireland retaining the cup. Signature moment brought to you by Rolex, one of the 41 matches that have been played. This is the 42nd edition of the Curtis Cup.
Opening match getting ready to go here with their second shots at the par 4 12th. Annabelle Fuller, Hannah Darling tied up against Rachel Heck and Rachel Keane.
Annabelle has been a bit shorter all day, but in match play can sometimes be an advantage to get on the green first and put some pressure on your opponent.
I think it's going to come up like right.
Yeah.
It's better to go here.
I think so. That's very well.
She and her caddy discussing the pin location. The hole location tucked so far on this right side. The wind has picked up a little bit into.
Nate Oxman, one of the local caddies, all of the players taking local caddies this week, getting as much knowledge as possible. She mentioned the ball slightly below her feet. It's going to tend to squirt to the right a little bit. That should be nice in this shot shape, but that is lost to the right, but catches. Some green, so not bad at all.
They talked that one out thoroughly. Fuller still wondering about that wind. Uninterrupted coverage of the 42nd Curtis Cup is presented by Rolex. And Rachel Heck next to play.
Also working on a downhill slope. 132 to this hole location. Really important to keep it left, unless you carry it like Annabelle did. You really don't want to hit out of this bunker. It's very deep on the right side.
That is 15 foot deep bunker. That is going to be all of the challenge for her.
Back at 11, Mega Gane.
Important for Gane to get this on the green. Her partner's in the right rough, and this needs to get up.
Oh, it,
okay.
It did.
I mean, not in trouble.
Darlene at 12.
Oh, the difference with the long drive, Julia.
Exactly, and with Rachel Keene in the right rough, green light for GBI. This is headed just center of the green, safe shot.
Hang on there.
There is a false front there. She's gonna settle. Not gonna be happy with that approach though.
McGinty at 11.
Yeah, and needs to hit a good one with her partner kind of long left. And this is all over with the sand wedge.
Rachel Keene at 12 coming out of the rough.
Yeah, very deep lie over here. She's gonna have to make some really good contact, really swing through this. It's on a very good line, if it can get there.
It does. That means it's settled.
Yeah, you see that the slope. She's gonna get some help back. That is a very speedy putt from above the hole on the left.
Par putt here at 10 for Roseng.
Well, if she makes it, she'll give Miriacho a great chance to win the hole.
Eleven again.
Mari Avery getting ready to go from the rough.
Decent line rough, just no way to control the distance on this shot.
She erred on the side of caution, which is the correct play. That's going to be a tough up and in.
Miliacho, this for birdie to win the hole.
Yeah, no free run because Rose didn't make her par putt, but still have to think that this is going to have a chance.
Oof. Good for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So Jamie and I in with par.
And just a little side note on the, you know, when you're talking about the caddies, it's part of the Curtis Cup tradition that the caddies are drawn for side and player. And you can switch around the caddies within your team if you want to, but it's not really, it's a bit frowned upon. But so it's just basically a blind draw, and that's how the caddies get paired with the player.
Certainly as a viewer, we want, it's a different dynamic this week than what we're used to seeing.
There's a lot of traditions that happen along the way, and I think it's all better for that. It's nice to retrace the history of the event through those traditions.
Yeah. Good par putt coming back.
Rachel Heck at 12 from that bunker.
A very difficult lie to get something to stop.
It was almost impossible to keep it between the edge of the green in that whole location, so not all bad from there.
Quick moment to let you know the USGA is unifying the game through the GIN mobile app in partnership with Sentry Insurance. You can join a growing community of more than 2 million golfers who post their scores and track their progress while using GPS and enhanced features. Download the GIN mobile app today. All right, they're going to figure out who's next to go here at 12.
they've discussed this quite a bit today. A few times they've played out of position in regards to who's further away. Annabelle's very, very good with her speed putting, and Hannah's been a little inconsistent with speed putting today from longer distances, so I think it's just about seeing who's comfortable, who's ready to go. If Hannah can get this close, Annabelle can go ahead and give it a run for birdie.
Yeah, Paige, it's sort of the strategy within the strategy of a match of...
Right, you're not just playing to what your opponent's doing, you're also figuring out how you best can it be in the most advantageous position and learn the most, as we've seen today, with the sometimes the shorter putt going first to give the longer putt a read.
Darling played in all five sessions last fall in Wales, went 2-1-2 for Great Britain and Ireland.
She's looking outside left here. Should move left to right the whole way.
Snap. Nearly.
Good pace. Par should be conceded, as it is. We drop back to 11 with Gane.
Yeah, that was a tough one to judge the speed right coming off that primary rough.
Looks like Fuller will be next. And Julia, it's interesting when they decided who to go, Darling maybe a little more uphill with that putt, where this could potentially be a bit quicker, maybe slightly more difficult for Fuller.
Yeah, the first half of this putt is definitely pretty quick, working downhill, and it'll swing right to left on her a good bit. Like I said, Annabelle is a very good putter, just leaving this one a little low and short.
It's all about the comfort level, Paige, if that's what they feel good about.
Absolutely.
You don't second guess. McGinty to win the hole, cutting to that lead.
Yeah, this, oh, she just hit that really tentatively.
That can happen out here at Merion. As our uninterrupted coverage of the USGA Championships. Presented by Rolex. Friday morning here at Merion Golf Club. Opening session of the 42nd Curtis Cup. Back to the green at 12. Chance for the Americans.
Rachel got a great look off of what Annabelle's putt did. Just a little bit closer. She saw Annabelle's putt really slow down when it got up towards the hole. She's looking higher right, giving it enough to break. And just hit it through it a little bit.
Rachel Keene knew it the moment she hit it.
This was the green I walked up on yesterday, and there was some past Curtis Cuppers playing on course and immediately said, yikes.
Avery to tie 11. Great putt there.
Yeah.
They maintain their two up lead. Now back to the green at 12. Rachel Heck for par.
It was a tall task to get up and down from that bunker and where she was. I think Rachel Keene, Julia, is probably kicking herself a little bit, not giving herself an easier two putt.
Yeah, I was very surprised that Rachel Keene went first there. I expected Rachel Heck to go, potentially make the par putt, and then Rachel Keene could go ahead and give it a run.
Sometimes, though, you don't want to overthink that. You know, if you're used to a certain rhythm, and as we are in normal golf, just kind of playing the furthest from the hole forward, it can be a little bit out of sorts in the rhythm of the pairing or grouping.
I agree. And I think it was just a mistake made by Rachel Keene to hit this 4 feet by the hole. You really, especially with GBI in for par.
Big putt.
Yeah, good two putt by Rachel Keene. That match remains all tied.
Now we're going to start getting position in the match when it's tight like this, and you just don't want to give anything away.
They head over to 13. We've got a quick moment, and we take a look at time now for Legendary Champions, presented by Rolex.
Fondest memory of the Curtis Cup is definitely playing four ball with Emma. I mean, when we were in the locker room, we had everything together. What's our handshake gonna be? When, how are we gonna celebrate? And which holes are each person's strong suit?
Me and Mariah have known each other for a very long time, and when Captain Port asked us if we wanted to play together, we said, do we want to play together? Yes, we have to play together. We're not playing. We had a handshake that was pretty powerful. I think it scared the other team away.
You know, there's this awesome photo of us really low high-fiving each other, and that's one of my representative photos of the Curtis Cup and just kind of what it embodies.
Match three on the 11th. Now, Paige, did you work on handshakes back at Bandon Dunes in 06 of how you were going to celebrate?
I don't think we had handshakes, but I do. I had Carol Simple Thompson, the legend, was our captain, and she said she was going to be coming up with pairings. And I said, I raised my hand. I said, do you want to know who we want to be paired with? She said, absolutely. So I gave my input, and for me, it was Amanda Blumenhurst, and we ended up being partners that week. But it was important to her, as it is, I think, for a lot of players and captains, that you mesh with the person that you're paired with.
Carol Semple Thompson, one of the 20 past players here this week at Marion's. Six past captains as well. Carol, two-time captain and competed 12 times in the Curtis Cup, more than any other player in U.S. history. Trying to figure out who's going to be going here. Karen?
There was a lot of finger pointing. Is it me? Is it you? They're all pointing to themselves. They all want to go first. But Louise Duncan won that one. She's out. Bit of a tough lie in the rough, though. Really fluffy around the ball. Had to get it up and over that tree.
Oh, I love that shot. You saw the speed that she had to hit that with as well, cutting through the rough, trying to get as clean as possible, not allowing the rough to hold up her club, and really nicely judged.
Par 3, 13, Rachel Keene.
107 to this short par 3. Headed a little left, but safe.
She hated it.
Yeah, common error when you're hitting a three-quarter shot is to get a little quick in the transition and not get the timing right. 107, you're licking your chops, but as you can see, it's pretty visually intimidating. And coming off the bunker, pretty severe downslope.
Rachel Heckner.
Going with a wedge here. Really important to get it carried over that bunker. And this is on a really good line.
Oh, yeah. Stopped dead in its tracks, too, on the downslope. Very nice.
Back to 11.
Roseanne getting ready to go.
And probably in the best position of the four players here. This group.
See if she can get a clean iron shot in here, Karen.
Yeah, she's done okay. Still came out a bit low though, Paige.
She didn't look happy.
Annabelle Fuller, GB and I needing an answer after a good one for the Americans.
Also going with a wedge here.
Go.
This is headed a little right, needs to get up.
Stayed in the rough, but
might be one of those.
Yeah, I was going to say, it doesn't make it easy, but if she can get clean contact on it, it's pretty straightforward. But the if is the big part of the equation.
Elaine Ratcliffe and Sarah LeBron Ingram, the captains, were the captains last time around, last year in Wales. USA there though. So fuller work to do, and a darling on the surface, the 18-year-old from Scotland.
plays South Carolina.
Yeah, has made an immediate impact at South Carolina when she came in. Had a chance to watch her play this season in collegiate golf at the Darius Rucker, their home event, and was immediately impressed watching her prepare on the range. Everything she did had intention. Very well prepared player.
See the bottom note there, 2021 RNA Girls Amateur Champ. She was 18 years of age. Birdie at 18 to win two up, both for Golf Club in Yorkshire. Now a star in collegiate golf here in America and at the Curtis Cup.
I was also impressed with the sound. You get a chance to hear it. You can even hear it through the screen, just how crisp she can strike it.
Back at 12, Lauren Walsh getting ready to go, Kay.
Berko, I do believe this is the first time they all have been in the fairway. And so we'll see what they can do from a somewhat equal playing field from the short grass. Lauren Walsh first, that's from 135 yards, plays a good half club uphill.
Safe. If your daughter is aged 6 to 17 and interested in the game of golf, you can enroll her in LPGA USGA Girls Golf, a program that the USGA has supported for more than 25 years. Help empower and energize girls in golf by visiting girlsgolf.org today. As we watch McGinty at 12.
There are elements of this golf course to my home course where I play back at home in Olympic Club, in that the fairways are just so tilted and you're dealing with a lot of uphill, downhill. It's like this golf course is always trying to put you off balance. And that was a nice, aggressive play.
Another great way to grow the game. Head on out here with your youngsters to watch.
It's inspiring.
The best.
They truly are the best. And you very rarely get an opportunity to be this up close and personal with this quality of golf.
And this golf course for maybe some getting a chance to walk around Merion is they're going to watch Megagane at 12.
Hey, this is a more level lie from the right-hand side of the fairway, but visually a harder angle.
Spin it.
Gets it to stop.
It's going to be speedy, but a good look.
Now the fourth member of this match, Amari Avery.
And when they all hit equally good tee shots, Amari is always out in front. Therefore, the last to hit. Ooh, she came out of that. A poor miss. That is a deep bunker.
Yeah, we saw Rachel Hetkin there a short while ago, and to get it inside 15, 20 feet is a monumental task.
Hannah Darling here for birdie at 13.
And her teammate Annabelle almost made her putt coming out of the rough with a putter. Short look at par. Hannah now has a 30-footer here, moving right to left on her for her birdie.
Chance for the Americans to win this hole. Keen for par first for Hex birdie putt. Okay. That's kind of been the strategy we've seen
for them. It appears that they've really found comfort in letting the short person putt first.
So this for birdie to win the hole.
Just 7 feet, but downhill the whole way. Coming off that slope, should see it move left to right.
Solid stroke.
Beautiful putt, beautiful tee shot. Win the hole, take a one-up lead, and find the play. I don't think that was a choreographed handshake. It came out naturally. Yeah.
Green at 11, couple of birdie putts. Watch Charlotte Heath go here first, Karen.
Absolutely, and Louise Duncan, though, has already putted, and then Roseanne putted in between. I would almost be inclined, if I was a GB&I player, to have let Charlotte Heath putt first, and then I would have putted. That way you get two GB&I putts first before Roseanne had a chance to have a look at hers. But as it is, here we are, still with a chance for GB&I to win the hole.
Good pace, par conceded.
And this is Paige, a great example of always having two putts, because all the pressure has now been on Rose, because Amelia hit a poor approach shot, went over the back of the green, couldn't get up and down for a par. So really everything on Rose, knowing that GB and I had two putts for a birdie.
Rose for par to tie the hole, keep that match tied. Rose 4-0-1 in Wales last year in the Curtis Cup.
Man's got a good voice.
Boy, you just lay out. You just want to hear it.
Yep.
Green at 12. What's going on here, Kay?
Well, Lauren Walsh just made a birdie attempt and her ball rolled by a good 5.5 feet. Her partner still has a birdie putt upcoming. Mari Avery has a putt from just off the putting surface for par after successfully getting out of that bunker. But this birdie putt that Megha Gane, looks like she's going to have Amari go ahead and putt first and see if she can hold this for a par and give Megha a little more free rein on her slippery downhill birdie putt.
I don't think we've seen really any putts come out clean from just off the green.
No, it's a unique way they have here, cutting the rough and not having a step cut in the fairway and really not having a traditional fringe.
It's the fine line. I think Merion tests you that way. It's absolutely fair. It will reward you with good shots, but if you're just a little off the green, a little off the fairway, it certainly can cost you.
Yeah, hard to make par when you're a little bit off. And this putt of Gane's is very fast. I think she just has to trickle it down there. She's a beautiful putter. Ooh, that has thought about going in, but it's a good 3+ by.
Megha Gane, just 18 years of age, but you've heard the name and you've seen her for a lot longer than that. Not one, not two, not three, a four-time drive, chip and putt, national finalist. Wonderful initiative at Augusta National Golf Club in the USGA has been such a big part of that Sunday morning at Augusta National. And we preach it, we talk about it. It truly can be the beginning of something special for the young men and women that compete and have a chance to qualify. And maybe your child will be next, as registration for the 2022-2023 Drive Chip and Putt qualifying now open. You can get your child registered today and he or she could become the next national champion. Join in on the fun. Go to drivechipandputt.com to get started. And that is McGinty's putt.
That was the second hole in a row she had a chance to win outright and was a bit tentative.
And like the first pairing, Paige, you alluded to Hannah Darling and Annabelle Fuller. In Wales last fall, Kaylee McGinty and Lauren Walsh were partnered together in that first day session of four ball. And like Darling and Fuller, both those matches picked up a point for Great Britain and Ireland. So, Kay, they're trying to sort of feed off that nice start they had a year ago in Wales.
And definitely, if you found a team that blends together well and brings you a point, you don't break it up.
Gane for par, yep, she's got it. A little more stress than she had hoped for. But they remain two up.
So they're all on the back nine. This morning session, 42nd Curtis Cup match. Americans one up in that opener. Avery and Gane two up. So a little bit of pressure perhaps on Duncan and Heath to try to get something out of that anchor match against Rosang and Amelia Migliaccio. But as we saw last year in Wales, Paige, an early opening lead really doesn't mean anything other than maybe building some confidence.
Absolutely not. We saw GB and I get off to a quick start last year.
Rachel Heck on the tee at 14, par 4, just under 400 yards.
And her partner, Rachel Keene, is in that bunker on the right side. Really important to get this in the fairway. This is on a really good line.
Yep, that'll open up the green.
Sure, as a player, especially as a youngster, you have a part of history like this. It's awfully special to feel a part of this.
It is, and you can draw the ties to former players, to professional golfers that played back in different Curtis Cups, and it certainly is a special sorority.
U.S. has been dominant. The only time Great Britain and Ireland won on U.S. soil, 1986 Prairie Dunes. 1986 Prairie Dunes. Back out to the tee here. 14.
Hannah Darling hit a great shot in the fairway here. This is headed left, and that's going to be a very difficult shot out of a deep bunker.
So that's the situation at 14. Back at 13, match two, Megha Gane will be first.
And this is just a cute little par three with the clubhouse behind, just such a beautiful setting. And what I love so much about this golf course is these short holes on the card, they look easy, but they're not. You still have to be so precise in order to make a birdie. Going at the flagstick. And why wouldn't you, with just a wedge of sorts in your hand? This green tilts a bit from left to right and a little from back to front.
You know, I find it a bit challenging, Kay, when you cannot see the green surface from the tee. There's little, you can see little parts of the green pop out, but you really gotta trust your number because there's not, I find it difficult to visualize when you cannot see where the ball is going to land.
Yeah, that's a great point. Trust the yardage. And I'd say, she needs to hit a good wedge here after a poor one at the last, and she has.
Ah, that girl. What a shot.
Brilliant. Where it landed, where it finished.
Well, and you have to trust the crowd reaction on that result because you cannot see the bottom of the flagstick. She just knew that felt good.
Lauren Walsh, the 21-year-old from Dublin, next.
The GB and I team, K, they don't know where it is.
No, but they know it was in tight, so they've got to bring two good shots here. They have to. They cannot afford to go any further down in the match. And they've only won one hole today.
Oh, what a response.
Solid answer there. Rachel Hutt, second to play at 14.
169 this hole location. Her partner, Rachel Keene, left it in the bunker on her second shot. So important to get this on the green.
Yeah, a long way from the hole, but on the surface. Meanwhile, Kaylee McGinty on the par three.
And Kaylee's really been the steadier of the two GB and I players in terms of ball striking, but really hasn't done anything magical with her putter yet.
They're going to need it. Appears, given Avery's position.
So 14, Annabelle Fuller, Julia?
I believe she's going to go. She's only 1 yard further away than her partner, so I think it was just a feel thing right there. Coming out of a really deep bunker, but hit that very clean.
Yeah, it seemed to pick it clean.
Oh, that's actually a fortunate bounce to come out of that long grass.
Scotch broom, the dunes grass in there. Part of the logo, right?
It is,
Scotch
yeah.
Broom. Yeah. Did my homework this week.
I'm impressed. Golfers are weathermen. Yeah. Also know a lot about foliage.
Uh-huh. Have to. What is the discussion now? Rachel Keane next.
Her ball was embedded. Took relief here.
Over. And gets the kick. Will it stop now? Ryan Frum, how about the embedded ball rule and the options for the players?
If the ball's embedded in the general area, they're just going to get a free drop, one club length, no nearer the hole from the spot immediately behind where it's embedded.
All right, darling, now.
An opening here for Hannah to hit something close and put a little bit of pressure. This is headed center green.
Oh, very nice. There is a little ridge. It's almost as runs like a canal through the green. That's what was repelling it a little bit, but still pretty straightforward putt relative to what the Americans are facing.
Final match at 12. Luis Duncan will be last to play here, Karen.
Longest drive by a significant way, but the downside to that is she is in the rough. Emilia Mediato hit the green from the rough just a little while ago. Charlotte Heath also on the green. Rosang did not hit the green and really sort of struggling a little bit finding her game at the moment. It's all very well, I think, on these holes round here on this side of the course if you can a little bit scrappy with your approach play, but as the deeper into this round you go, the better quality iron shots are going to really start to pay dividends. So that was for some thick, juicy grass, but Ruiz is strong.
Oh, yes.
He's had a couple of nice approaches the last two holes out of the gnarly stuff.
Who needs a fairway, Paige? Tell me you got to play it from there.
To the par 3, 13th, Megagane for birdie.
McGinty putted first, missed her birdie putt. Megagane now from a good spot here, Paige. I don't think there's a terrible amount of break from this angle. Uphill.
What?
Ran it.
Wow. Aggressive with a capital A.
Yeah.
She's outside of her partner's birdie putt.
Know what they're cheering for?
Not exactly what Amari was looking for. You want to have your partner just get in safely with a par, so that she can loosen up and just play that little birdie putt more aggressively. Now Lauren Walsh, she was on virtually the same line as her partner, Kaylee McGinty. In fact, she moved her ball mark over to allow for Kaylee's putt. So she knows this moves a little bit to the left.
See some opportunities not taken advantage of too.
It's been not the most lightning display of putting that we've seen so far this week, but you can tell how difficult these greens are with the speed, just matching it up.
Par putt for Gane. Avery still with a birdie putt. In for three with a chance. Already two up in the match.
Yeah, this is another big moment for this young team, who I mentioned they played teamed up together at the Junior Solheim. They were actually 2-0 in team play.
Solid.
Never a doubt. So you win the hole, go 3 up, heading to 14. All red throughout. Took the lead, the win at the first. Match 1 here at 14 as they crowd around the green.
You get a sense of that ridge that I was speaking of. It kind of dips down and comes back up, which is what Rachel's going to have to negotiate, Julia.
Kind of on her own here on this hole as well with the difficulties Rachel Keene had out of the bunker. Leaving that for par.
Still work to do for a par for the U.S. So Keene played from the bunker to here. This her fourth now?
I believe so. Bunker to embedded to here. Just hoping to get a chip in here.
Back at 12.
Charlotte Heath sizing this one up for birdie for Great Britain and Ireland.
Erzang has played out of the left bunker and has about a 6 footer for her par. And this putt is pretty scary. Breaking to the right.
At least you're honest.
No, this, I mean, I walked up on this green and was genuinely gobsmacked at how they were going to get that many hole locations.
I thought that too when I played it yesterday. I was like, oh my goodness. It's really where you have to pick your spot and stick to it. And this is already going low. It's so hard to believe how high you have to hit that.
When they did redo these greens, they had heat maps and figured out if they had to enlarge it or change it to make sure that they did have plenty of hole locations.
Yeah, and the greens as a whole 12% bigger after that renovation.
Ghana on the tee.
Yeah, and this is a bit of a beast of a hole. It's uphill the entire way from the tee to the green, playing back into the wind.
It looks very narrow to the eye when you're standing on that tee, given the shape of the fairway.
Yeah.
Not hoping that, ooh, that gets awfully close to the primary rough.
Up on the green here, Hannah Darling for birdie to win the hole.
From the bottom of this valley, working uphill the whole way. Hit it through it.
Made sure to get it there.
Okay.
Avery back on the tee.
Yeah, wind picking up while she's over the ball. I think even with her length, she's not going to challenge that bunker, but this going way right. Ooh, up in the rough.
Yeah.
She may want to come over and say hello to you guys in the booth.
Julia, who's away here at 14?
I believe they're trying to figure that out now. They called in a rules official to see. If USA is away, Keene will be first to go.
So it's a bogey putt for Keene. Heck, has a par putt?
Yes, exactly. After that embedded ball, no penalty stroke, she was able to get it up here.
We've kind of entered this last portion of the golf course, and Karen Stuffles described it as well. There is a bit of hanging on through the challenging holes where sometimes par is going to be enough in this match play format. Whereas in early parts of the day, we were looking at a lot more birdies.
Not much to this bogey putt for Keene. Working uphill. She just pulled that.
Quick stroke in the transition.
Rachel Huck will have a par putt when we get back here. Back to 12, though.
Charlotte Heath, this for par to tie the Americans who are already in with their par, Karen.
Yeah, Amelia put a really nice putt down there. Just a matter of inches. Almost a bit unlucky. Gravity didn't put it into the hole, but easy down by Charlotte Heath. She's been putting well.
Great Britain and Ireland 4, United States of America 4. The match remains tied. Oh, holy shit.
We're just laying out the entire week. Heck, a moment ago for par. With a putt to tie.
And it felt like she was in the driver's seat the entirety of this hole. Great drive, great approach shot. Just running her birdie putt a little too far by. Now she has a downhill left to right to save her par.
Dangerous time here, too. One down in the match. They tie the hole, and the Americans remain one up. As we remind you, uninterrupted coverage of this 42nd Curtis Cup is presented by Rolex. Gallery making its way to the 15th. Check the leaderboard, see where we stand. So you've got two of the three in red on the board right now. And that three-up lead significant for Avery and Gunning.
Yeah, they've been a very fun duo to watch. A lot of energy in the youth of that pairing. But keep an eye on that lead match. We've seen it swing both directions. U.S. had a lead to start. GB and I took it over. Now U.S. back at it. See if Great Britain and Ireland can answer with just four remaining.
So the match that is tied right now, match three, reaching that par three 13th hole. Four ball this morning, foursomes this afternoon. That's what it'll be tomorrow as well. And then the eight singles matches on Sunday to close it out.
This match has been a really interesting one, Terry, in that the Great Britain Ireland players have generally been playing better ball striking, you know, more quality shots into the greens, giving themselves chances. The American team, they've not been striking the ball quite so well, but typically what you've been seeing is that one of the players has kind of got away with a bit of a scrappy shot and, you know, two-putted for par. What we're seeing here is just a lack of birdies being made on this golf course. I mean, that's such a difficult course, though, Paige, to do that with these hole locations that are just so hard to get close to.
It's a great point. And it's interesting how that shapes the momentum, too, as the way you described it. If one team has kind of had one person out of the hole or not really making those advances, you want to be able to ride the momentum as the opposing team. And if you're not making putts, it makes it really difficult.
And I think if you're the GB and I team, you have to be a little bit patient with it because they've got to feel that they should be a couple up by now.
Oh, what a great shot.
Americans won the fourth hole. GB and I won the fifth. Tied up since. Gane on the way. Here's second at 14.
Yeah, two balls in the fairway. Mega Gane, one of them coming in with hybrid. Such a long second shot uphill.
Let's see if it'll climb that. That'd be very similar position to where we saw Hannah Darling.
Duncan on the tee at 13.
Duncan has a really high ball flight. Can really fly this one there with Heath in close. This one's left though and long.
Up to 14 again, Amari Avery, deep rough.
Yeah, so hard to control it, even with her strength, trying to gouge it out and get it somewhere near the front of the green. She can't even see where it landed. There's some humps and bumps in between her ball and the hole.
Not gonna love it. Americans looking for an answer back on the tee at 13. Zhang.
She could do it, getting a little bit of air under this. Her shots have been coming into the green a little bit low and a bit flat. If you do that here, it's going to scoot on too much. Oh, this needs to get up. Oh,
wow,
they hooked in the face too.
We've seen her play spectacular golf and win big events. Hasn't brought her A game so far today.
Not yet, but it's actually reminiscent after she finished the NCAA championship as in the stroke play portion. Her first match back out in the morning was not great in the quarterfinals, but then she picked it up in the semis and became the Rose Zhang that we know. But we've seen her have to find something, and she has been off. From what we are used to or accustomed to.
Big wins, including that recent NCAA individual championship. Iliacho now.
Well, she's been picking up the slack for the team. I think if I was Team USA, I would have Amelia hit first right now because Rose needs to not worry about the pressure, and Amelia certainly needs the pressure taken off her.
That is no bargain. Up to 14, Kayla McGinty second.
And she most likely is going to be flying solo on this hole. An aggressive tee shot has left her just 170 yards. Her partner is in trouble, Lauren Walsh is.
And she is now too, at least in the bunker. Could have been worse. So this was earlier. Lauren Walsh, this is what happened. Saw where she was. Yeah.
I mean, at that point, I mean.
Now live from the bunker, third.
And not able to get to the green from that lie. She was too close to the front lip. I'm really making a mess of this hole.
14's been a struggle.
It has been. It's one of the tough ones.
Yep. A moment to remind you, no matter your age, gender, or skill, a handicap index provides every golfer with a universal measure of playing ability and enhances the fun, social aspects of your game. To get your handicap index and receive other great benefits from your local Allied Golf Association, sign up at usga.org/get a handicap.
You know, to finish my thought on the 14th, playing 399 yards today, but it's right back into the face of it. A lot of players are challenged with the drive because it doesn't look like there's very much landing area, and it runs out on the right so quickly. But you don't want to lay back because it's such a long approach into this green. So you're challenged on both the first shot and the second shot on this 14th.
Imagine the foursomes.
Oh, we got a lot to look forward to this afternoon.
First look at the par 4 15th opening match has arrived here, and Fuller hopping into that bunker getting ready to go.
Yeah, a couple wayward drives on this hole. Three players hit it out to the right. Annabelle's stayed in this bunker, 120 to this hole location, but she just has 5 paces over the greenside bunker. Has to get it up high and out.
All things considered,
I mean,
Paige,
a long
bad.
Putt, but yeah. You're on the putting surface from that location.
Great look from high above. Finishing 5 holes on the other side of the clubhouse coming in.
It visually is so beautiful because the fairway's canting the direction of that dog leg as well. And so you stand on that tee and you just feel and see what the architect was intending to do when Hugh Wilson originally sculpted this out.
Homes aren't bad in this area either.
It's pretty decent real estate.
Rachel Keene next to go.
A great angle from this left side of the fairway. Where this hole location's cut, she has a little bit more green to work with. 106, and that's a little left.
She might have been hoping for a little bit of fade off of that lie, but not a bad position at all with that hole location.
Now Heck from the rough.
Not a horrible lie, but over here, you're short-sighted, coming out of the rough, really difficult to get this ball to hold. She's just looking to get something up on this green and not leave it short in the bunker.
A couple of looks for birdie upcoming at the 15th for the Americans, and Heck getting a little bit better. Uninterrupted coverage of the USGA Championships is presented by Rolex.
Match 3 at 13. Louise Duncan, lengthy birdie try.
It is a pretty slippery one down the hill. Heath is in there pretty close. The Americans are in trouble.
This looks pretty good, though.
It sure does.
Oh, looks great. Wow. What a putt.
And so important in this final match as they sit all square.
Darlene at 15.
Also coming out of the rough. She knows Hex in there, somewhat tight.
Okay.
Well,
Mack and Keane, one up as they arrive on the green at 15. We go back to 13.
All the pressure on the Americans, Miliancho. This is to tie the hole.
Yep, Rosanne came out of the bunker, did not make it, has to chip this.
Unlikely putt going in. Expect the unexpected in match play.
United States of America 3, Great Britain and Ireland are one up.
Sorry, I almost interrupted my man. Never want to do that. So they take the lead in that match number 3. Talked about that being so competitive going back and forth, and now Great Britain and Ireland up. 3-up lead for Avery and Gane, though, the biggest lead on the board right now. So the other two very competitive here on the back 9. Trying to keep this straight at 14. Walsh for bogey, Kay?
Yes, and I'm kind of perplexed as to why GB&I is putting this putt. Her partner has a long par putt, but basically, Mega Gane has a putt just inside on virtually the same line, so she's going to get a free tee chair.
Yeah. And in fact, it looked like Mega was kind of sneaking in to take a good peek at it.
Yeah, I would have picked this up and focused on Kaylee McGinty's upcoming par putt.
Watch Mega walking in on this too, checking it out. I mean, she got it. Perfect teach.
She had to ask her to move because she's standing right behind her.
That uncomfortable with where Gane was watching from.
But that just makes no sense because that bogey really is irrelevant.
Nothing.
Yeah.
And now you just gave Mega green light. Teach on this putt to win the hole and go 4 up.
Ginty still has a par putt, but yeah, this would win the hole.
Just to go 4 up with 4 to play. Oh, she pushed it, but that'll be an easy par.
So McGinty still has a par putt to tie the hole.
Yeah, McGinty's second shot ended up over the green in the bunker. A tough place to play from since the green sloped away. She actually hit a pretty good bunker shot, but it just released out to this point. She can't buy a putt today.
Oh, that's good. Great Britain and Ireland 5. United States of America 4.
Turn the motor on. Why does he's talking?
It's so rude. Disruptive.
4 up, 4 to play for the Americans in that match to 15.
Hannah Darling, Annabelle Fuller, one down in this match. Julia could use a little flip to the script.
Yeah, it would be really big to roll a putt in here for Hannah Darling. Her partner Annabelle left her long birdie putt 10 feet short. This will be a quick one for Hannah, working downhill, right to left the whole way.
This point, Paige, of if you're GB&I, really trying to maybe force the issue
and that, I think, is a hard part at this corner of the golf course, is it makes it very difficult to try to press for birdies when it is just challenging. Sometimes it's going to be a patience game, but that can be hard in 4 ball when you've got 4 balls in the air.
Keen for birdie to win, Julia. Now she maybe has to reassess her thoughts and I'm being aggressive.
Yeah, her partner's in here also pretty close. She just played that way too high.
And a big mistake in this stage. You know, you want to put yourself in a position to be conceded. And I think that's kind of what we're seeing, too, throughout this morning session is we haven't seen a lot of concessions. We've had a lot of putts roll out. And incredibly frustrating as a player to be in that position where it's just constant grinding.
Now Keane's going to finish up. It looks like.
She will have done this basically the whole day.
So Keane trying to get the Americans in with par.
Too. I mean, for these players not typically working with caddies, and yes, they're local caddies, they know these greens, but sometimes you don't use those reeds because it does throw off your rhythm. So it's that balance as a player of figuring how much input do you really want, not to overthink it.
Heck to go two up.
And to Paige's point earlier, you might hit these putts a little differently knowing your partner's in there. The out-of-turn play can sometimes play with your mind a little bit.
Kind of good that Keane made that putt for par.
Well, and that's the other thing, is now you're given the opportunity to be aggressive, but you don't play those putts aggressively normally on your ball. You have to maintain that same rhythm that you would normally go through in trying to just two-putt or get it down there.
Fuller. Are some great putts by Annabelle at 9, 10, 11. Really needed that one to go. Now the pressure really on Hannah Darling.
A short one here, but there's a lot of slopes around these holes. Minuscule slopes that can affect these short putts. Coming off the bunker here, there's a slope that's feeding down towards the hole, but her putt worked right to left the whole way, so sometimes difficult to read these short putts.
It's probably also part of why we haven't seen a lot of concessions. But important putt. She made a nice cleanup on the last hole.
Just to stay one down.
Yep.
Nice one. So that opening match heads on over to 16. Morning session winding down here at Merion. Heck and Keane maintaining that one-up lead. Avery and Gane, four up, four to play. Duncan and Heath, one up, five remaining against Zhang and Migliaccio.
Do you really want to play 14? You look forward to it?
I did before I saw this.
Yeah, exactly.
Not a lot of golf courses I drive by and think, I really wish I had my golf clubs today. And this is one of them.
Amelia Migliaccio, I believe, first to go here.
She is. Her tee shot just disappeared off into the rough. It's not a bad lie in the rough.
So they wait there. Take it to 16 tee.
Keane, ready to go with driver.
Just trying to take this up the right center of the fairway. And that's exactly what she's doing.
Nice.
Thank you.
I'll fade it.
That's a perfect line.
Fade it, right? Yes. Good. Like a field goal between two tall trees.
Migliaccio ready to go at 14.
182. Ball is on an upslope. Got a hybrid out. She was working on a more of a little punchy kind of swing here with a practice swing. Got to work at this one, not going left. This one's come out a bit hot, to be honest.
Oh, there it is.
Popped back out. Might be a difficult stance, but doesn't it look too bad for being off of the green?
Up to 16.
Heck, ready to play.
Yeah, our partner's in good position, so just looking to get another ball in the fairway here. To give themselves two good looks in the fairway. And this is headed left.
We'll find it.
Yeah, I think
that's how it bounced.
Saw it bounce. We don't see it now. That is the eternal optimist on the team by Rachel Keane. 15. McGinty.
Yeah, all four players in the fairway. McGinty first from 128. Oh, just carries the front, clears that bunker.
She hated it, Kay.
Well, she didn't strike it well, but it was one of those spin to win shots.
Right now, they'll do anything to win a hole.
Well, and on the low side of the hole, so not a bad position.
Roseng at 14.
From 179, balls above her feet on an upslope. Hybrid. This one's a little bit out to the right.
Catches right up against.
I mean, I'm just curious how she's going to play that. We've seen a little bit. We've seen that Texas wedge. It's going to be very difficult to get a putter through there.
Avery getting ready to go at 15.
Megagane is safely on the green, just about hole high left, giving Mari Avery now an opportunity to be more aggressive from the left-hand side of the fairway. 115 yards to the hole, plays a little bit uphill.
She could use a good one, Kay.
Yep. Another good wedge like she hit at 13. This has a good line.
Great shot.
Beautiful rhythm to that swing. And that was a big part of her game going to USC, working with Justin Silverstein, honing in on wedges and putting.
This is when you start seeing the captains and the team managers popping up coming down the stretch.
Second for Charlotte Heath at 14.
Duncan has already hit the green. This is another good shot.
Just gets to that ridge. I know, it's, and stops.
It's like, I don't know how else to describe it other than like a little canal through the green.
Lauren Walsh up next at 15.
Hit a really nice drive here, hugging the right-hand side, cut off a little bit of distance to the hole. Just 120 yards left. To win the hole or it's over. Oh, that was kind of a nifty play.
They want to keep playing. Good one there by Lauren Walsh. Quick moment to let you know for all the latest news and information about the 42nd Curtis Cup match, follow at Curtis Cup on Twitter and Instagram and join the conversation using the hashtag Curtis Cup. Paige, you've been involved in this match. What does a captain tell the team about getting that first point, trying to set a tone, whether it's that first match, the anchor match, just seeing your color up there on that board?
Yeah, I mean, the captain's going to tell these players to play their own game, take care of their own business, their own match, and worry about the team later. I think, though, if you're a player, there's enormous pride and getting those points on the board, to seeing, as you say, the flag on the board, setting the tone early, being in control of matches too, having the honor on the tee, and doing all of those things to feel like you're more in control of the match than the opponent is.
Yeah, and we talked about Megagane and Mari Avery as rookies on this U.S. team. But remember last year in the fall, Mega went over as second alternate to Wales, and talking to some of the U.S. team that was there and back here this year, like, she's part of our team. She might not have hit a golf shot, but she understands the dynamic and truly the magnitude of what this event's all about. And maybe you lose the nerves and butterflies and say, hey, I've been there, I've watched, now I'm ready to go out and play.
Well, it certainly Paige gives her, you know, there's no element of surprise with what she was prepared for entering this team. But I think Megagane is just, she's got that megawatt smile, megawatt personality. She brings so much energy and excitement to the team. I think the addition of Mega and Amari Avery, along with Latana Stone, has just been a great injection for this Team USA.
This to put a point on the board for the Americans.
Left to right breaking putt initially.
Settle.
Well, she is always very aggressive.
No, I would say, to expand upon your point, Kay, both of these players, the U.S. team, do not shy away from the spotlight. They thrive in it. They like the big moments. And this is about as big a moment as you're going to get in women's amateur golf.
Let's go up to that first match at 16. Rachel Heck, they did find it.
She found it, but it's deep down in here. And Annabelle just hit a very nice shot from the middle of the fairway to this tough hole location. Just six paces over a big ridge in the middle of this green. Downwind for Rachel Heck.
Oh, what a shot. Got a ton of release, but it is a pretty blind shot from down there, as you could see from that camera angle. A lot of trust and a long approach.
Maybe Rachel Keane knew why she was so optimistic to her teammate. Now let's see what Gane is going to do here at 15K.
Yeah, McGinty missed her birdie putt. And Amari's having Mega go ahead and make this par putt. It's on a similar line, so I think she'll learn a little something about the break of this putt for her own upcoming birdie putt. I tell you what, Mega's money on those 5 and 6 footers.
Again, the Americans just have to tie this hole to win the match. Four up, four to go.
Yeah, and this putt would do it if she can make it. Lauren Walsh still has an upcoming birdie putt, but if Amari makes it, then that's good enough to win the match.
Yeah, you talk about the nerves of getting out there for the very first time. Consider who's not playing for the Americans this morning. The U.S. amateur, women's amateur champion, and Latonna Stone, who had a wonderful opportunity to win the Augusta National Women's Amateur.
Yeah, this team is about as deep as it can get. And that's their strength.
So Amari Avery, the 19-year-old, to win the match.
Well, that was a really nice putt.
We'll wait on the upcoming putt by Walsh. Darling now second at 16.
Yeah, partner in with a really good shot. 109 here.
Oh, this is really good by Hannah Darling.
Fabulous.
Almost using that method, hit it as far down there as I can.
I was looking at my yardage book saying she hit it through the fairway on her tee shot.
Now a huge putt for Lauren Walsh at 15.
Oh, you can say that again for the upcoming senior this fall at Wake Forest. It either goes in and they go on, or it's matches over. No pressure.
The finality of match play.
Oh, she has so much experience playing internationally and in a previous Curtis Cup.
How about that?
Huge.
Kay's mentioning it, not a lot of putts have fallen yet for this team, so a little bit going their way as they live to play another hole.
So take it down to 14. Heath for par, Karen?
It is for par. She had a really good look at birdie and just raced it way past, as did Duncan as well, race her putt past. Rosang played a quite a sporty little chip from over the back. She'll have a putt for her par as well. They're all around that sort of 5 foot range. Emilia did not make her par. So at some point, something's got to give here. But GB and I have two putts for a par. And then it will fall down to Rose.
Prediction, foursomes this afternoon, par wins the hole.
Yes. Go out on a limb for me, Cherry.
I'm kind of hoping that they make some easier hole locations for this afternoon for the foursomes.
Well, they have a lot of options.
Yes, they do.
These greens.
This one downhill. It is speedy. Okay.
So in for a par. Zhang has par putt now?
She does. And Paige, you were wondering how she was going to play it. She did use a putter for that little shot from the collar.
Left a little to be desired.
Yeah, this one's difficult because it's going to break a bit down to the left. It's not just an easy...
There are straight putts out there. Am I wrong?
Where? I'm not sure I've seen them.
It can just keep you on your heels.
It is. And Team USA are one down already. This is... you feel this is must-make for Rose.
Yeah. I mentioned that she was a little bit off in that first match in NCAA. She also was as she was trying to win the NCAA tournament individually and found something at the end of the round.
So GB and I went up in that match. Reminder, uninterrupted coverage of this 42nd Curtis Cup presented by Rolex continues later today, 2:30 Eastern. And check us out on Peacock. Afternoon foursomes matches. Four ball in the morning, first 2 days, out to 16.
Fuller, long par putt.
Yeah, I didn't hit a very good chip coming out of the rough up there, and just trying to make that to give Hannah a good run for birdie.
Yeah, it feels like Darlene's gonna fly solo here the rest of the way at the 16th.
A good look at this green, because there's a lot of movement in the greens, but this is the first one that you're seeing that actually is like a true tier. The 16th and 17th have pretty massive slope to get to this upper portion.
So Rachel Heck, Rachel Keene, one up in this opening match. This would be an unbelievable three for Heck if she could get it to go.
It would. 40 feet for this birdie putt. She's almost on a baby tier up at the top of this green. Has to be really conscious of her speed. And this can get going pretty fast.
Rest conceded. A heck of a four for Rachel.
I see what you did there.
You like that?
From this side, it goes off the edge. I don't think quite as much as you saw it. From this side, I got you good.
Now, Hannah Darling.
This has been a very back and forth match all day. Each side has held the lead. This would be big.
Yep, for birdie to win the hole, tie the match. Chances you're going to get.
At this stage in the game, you want to be able to take advantage of those opportunities. It looks as though it came out a little bit left right off the face, but running out of holes, and it's hard to know when you're going to find another good look like that to try to win one.
From the green at 16 to the tee at 15 with Migliaccio.
Both Great Britain and Ireland players are in play down the fairway, and this is a nice little draw for Amelia down the fairway also.
Keep it here with Rose Zhang, and you touched on it, Paige. That final round of NCAA started the day with a 7-shot lead, extended it to 9, and then some chasers got close. Rose opened the door. Her lead was down to 3, and then stoned it on 13, and it was game, set, and match.
Paige, I almost think that when I watch Rose, sometimes there's a little lack of urgency in terms of how she swings sometimes, and that's where some of the shots come from that are a little bit iffy. This one's also out to the right. I'm going to be in trouble in the rough.
And a little over-rotation on that particular swing. If you look at the top of the golf swing, you'll see her almost tip back towards her forward foot. And you wonder if that wasn't part of just the timing right here. So you're going to tip back. Massive rotation. And then it's difficult to get that weight transfer back to the right side so that you can shift it back to the left through impact.
And on the way at 17. Hanging in there. It does. See the tiers of that green.
McGinty at 16.
Got to take advantage of this good tee shot from the right-hand side of the fairway. Her partner's in the left rough.
Oof.
Oh, totally duffed that.
Oh, wow.
Rachel Heck, good look at 17, the par 3, 189.
Going with a 5-iron here. Her partner's on safe out to the right. Trying to get this on the top tier. And this is headed a little right as well.
Yeah, it's okay.
16. Avery.
Two good tee shots for Team USA. They are in a very strong position now with a good chance to both get it on the green and have birdie putts.
Avery and Gane, three up, three to go.
Yeah, it looks like Walsh is going to be next to hit. And this is, well, any lie in the rough here. The rough hasn't been cut for several days. It's long, it's thick. The rough is lying crossways across the ball. She does have a clear look at the hole, but she's, I think, going to have to play it a little right of the flag stick. Trying to get it up on that same tier where the hole's located.
Yep.
Pretty good for
them.
Yeah,
well done. I mean, they're in a position where they need to make a move, so it still may not be enough, but at least she's got a good putt at it.
Yeah, a tie will not do them any good, where tying the hole for Team USA will win them the match. A more aggressive line by Mega Gane.
Oh, tremendous. A lot of that was just position off the tee. The United States, you probably couldn't have placed it in a much better position than where Amari and Mega were located.
Over to the tee at 17, Hannah Darling.
And her partner Annabelle hit a beautiful hybrid, just one or two paces short from getting up there close to this pin. And it came all the way down. Hannah now on a really good line if it gets over this ridge.
Yeah, hole location only four paces over that ridge, so not a lot of room to play with, but that a very nice shot.
Annabelle Fuller's ball there up front, or in the front tier at least. Yeah, just off. See the layout, not close these two are.
There we go from 17, couple hundred yards left, over to 15 with Charlotte Heath.
Yeah, she's going to be first to play. Longest shot in here. Whole location tucked on that very far right. I think if you're the first play in here for your respective team, the smart play, prudent play is left of this flag, hit the middle of the green, and give your partner a free try at it. This one's got to go just a smidge. Okay.
It did.
How about just go at it then?
Yeah.
And it's
tremendous.
Really good. Miliaccio up next, Karen.
She is. And again, she's in a good position on the fairway. She's looking over at Rose to see what's going on. Okay, she's got the club pulled now and moving in. And one thing I say about these fairways, I mean, they are particularly tight. They roll the fairway. So if you're not feeling so confident in how your striking is going with your irons, it's every shot is intimidating when you stand over it. green is above the players. This one's smidge left. So she did that, what she needed to do. Smart play to the middle of the green.
From the green at 15 to the green at 16. Kay, give us an update.
Well, McGinty is ball in pocket. Her ball was in the middle of the scotch broom and decided she couldn't help her partner except for coming up on the green and give her some moral support and a read of the putt if necessary. So they're going to rely on Lauren Walsh to try to make birdie again and hope Team USA misses. Amari Avery will be first to putt from long distance. I think she'd do quite well to get this down within a 3-foot circle from a good 50 feet away. But her partner's in very, very close with a really good birdie opportunity. Well, this has a nice line. Excellent speed control. That's just what she was trying to do.
It's a good feeling when you get the concession.
So the four conceded, as Kay said, Megagane in close, but doesn't really matter. Lauren Walsh has to make this to keep on playing.
And it's so hard when you're in a position like this, but you know what? Sometimes you just relax and say, she's not supposed to make a putt from 45 feet, but it could happen. Leaning on her caddy, Eumann Jones. All these Merion caddies are so knowledgeable. They're all the top caddies from this club, like Karen said, who randomly were drawn and assigned to players. She dug down deep and got the birdie to fall on the last hole, but this is a much taller, harder putt.
See if she can do it again.
Wow. That was such a good looking putt.
So, it's official. First point on the board. For Team USA, Amari Avery, Megagane, 3-2 winners over Kaylee McGinty and Lauren Walsh.
Let's go.
Take you over to 17. Pretty impressive that the two rookies together are the first point on the board for the Americans.
Without a doubt, they unintimidated by the moment.
Rachel Keene here, top part of the green.
Her partner Rachel Heck left her birdie chip about 9 feet short. She's trying to lag something down there.
Remember, a one-up lead for the U.S. in this match. So Annabelle Fuller has a par putt. Darling has a birdie try. Yeah, there's the par. Go ahead. Trying to make that first.
She hit a great putt from about 10 yards or so off this green to get it up here to 3 feet.
Nicely done.
Keep an eye in with a par. Darling reading the birdie putt, which would win the hole.
And she got a great look from Rachel Keene off of her birdie putt. Got to see the speed. Putting down a little ridge on the right side of the screen. They're looking out on the right, breaking right to left the whole way.
One down in the match, trying to tie it up.
It's worth noting there's no playoffs. These are half points if they were to finish in a tie.
So they're in with a par, remember.
The rules are very weird. I didn't want to, like, touch it and then, you know.
She knew, but she didn't know.
I know, but, like, you're not supposed to touch it while it's still moving. And
no, yeah, I know. I'm asking.
Yeah, pretty smart.
Yeah, it seems pretty.
Just to be safe. A couple of par putts here for the Americans.
Not much going on with Rachel Heck's putt for par. Uphill. Might move barely to her left.
How long is this one now?
This one's about 3 feet from the hole, and the Americans really haven't had a ton of pressure for these putts in a few holes, so might bring out her nerves a little bit. She's been good from this length today, though.
Yep, to guarantee a half point. They keep that one up lead with one to play. Got a moment. Let's send it down to Ken.
Thanks very much. I'm with a very, very happy rookie team. You guys, what did it mean to you to go out there and get that first point as rookies on the Curtis Cup?
Oh, I didn't even think about that, but we're very excited. And we actually played together in the Junior Solheim last year. So just the fact that we were both here from just playing in the Junior Solheim to the Curtis Cup, we were saying it's a big step forward, and we're really excited about this pairing.
Yeah, Amari, you guys went one up on the first hole and you never looked back. How key was it to control the match the entire day?
Yeah, I think it was pretty key. Just like you said, we're a rookie team, so not much to expect from us out there. But just kind of starting strong, I think, was something, our game plan a little bit. And we held on to it for the longest time. And I think we only lost maybe one or two holes. So just staying strong was the key and got it done.
Well, so far as a team, I guess you're undefeated. Well done. Great to watch you today. Terry?
It's great. She's like, initially, Megan, oh, we're rookies. That's right. I didn't even think about that.
Certainly didn't feel like it.
Didn't play like it either. And they did take control right from the start. 3-2 the win, Avery and Gane. So 1 point on the board for the U.S., guaranteed a half a point in this match. Keen off the tee at 18.
On a great line, just finishing out that American flag down in the fairway.
Yeah, visually, it's not the easiest. Don't know exactly where your ball is landing. It is picking a point in the distance. You can see that American flag behind the green. A good target for the players off of the tee.
All the history here with this hole, too, through the years, including Ben Hogan. One iron. Heck no.
The wind down and working a little left to right. Another great tee shot.
Wow, indeed. Eventually. She'll play first. Fuller.
After two great tee shots by the Americans, really important for Annabelle to hit a good one here and get it in the fairway.
Has played so historically difficult in at least the most recent U.S. Open. We saw that rolling into the rough, going to make it a little bit more challenging. So important to give yourself as good of look as possible into this long par four.
They've got to win the hole to get a half a point.
Hannah with an advantage here. She's a very long driver of the golf ball. If she can get something down there, a shorter club in her hand might be beneficial.
Settles in. Gonna be really tough from there. Drop it back to 15.
Charlotte Heath to win the hole for Great Britain and Ireland.
Gonna have a little bit of movement to the right.
Oh.
That was painful.
That was for birdie at 15. And let's send it back down to Kay.
All right, I'm alongside USA captain Sarah Ingram. Your thoughts first off on what Amari Avery and Mega Gane just did, putting the first point on the board.
I think it's amazing. I knew that they would be a great pairing together and you know, have lots of fire. So I'm pleased with that. Pleased to get the first point.
Well, in that first match out is one up going to 18. So are you going to head over to 18 and say anything to them, or you just kind of get your vibe there and hopefully give them some good confidence?
I'm just going to go over there. I've been watching them a lot actually today, and they've been fighting really hard. Just go there and, you know, congratulate them no matter what happens.
You're there to support no matter what. Well, best wishes for a good morning session. Let's go over to Burko.
Okay, thanks so much, Sarah. LeBron Ingram, captaining the Curtis Cup in the American team for the second consecutive year, was a three-time member of the U.S. Curtis Cup team as well. Three-time women's mid-amateur champ, runner-up at the Women's Am in 93, low am at the 1995 U.S. Women's Open, a decorated career after a standout 4 years at Duke University. Let's head out to that last match. Duncan on the tee at 16.
Not using a driver here, just you got to play it down to that little corner there. The more left you can keep the drive, the better off you are. Heath's down the fairway.
Oh. That one disappeared quickly. So a chance for the Americans. Emiliano going with driver.
This is quite a strong play here.
Yeah, we saw Hannah Darling actually drive it through the fairway.
Yeah.
Up the left portion.
I think Amelia needs to be looking just a little bit more down the right side so she has more room with that run out. She hit the ball a long way on the previous hole, so this is a little surprising, but this one's going to be just fine.
A little more fairway on the right portion as it kind of slopes and shapes up the hill.
And we've seen a shift. We saw Roseanne play first on the par 3 13th. Now we've seen Amelia take the lead off the tee. I think this was a good change for this group, because I think Roseanne being first felt pressure to hit the quality shot in. Even though she's world number one, I think she was still feeling it, and which left Amelia really having to pick up the pieces. But with this little shift, it's kind of freed Amelia up to go ahead and plod one down the fairway, and Rose has freed herself up too.
Yeah, you touched on that a few holes ago, Karen, and to see that switch internally, you know, frees them both up to try to hit a quality shot.
And who knows, maybe that's something, you know, the captain, when they talk about strategy, would advise their players to think about that kind of internal momentum.
Right, Ruff, both players 18, GB and I. Fuller first. See the golf ball here. It's not the deep rough, it seems.
No, not a bad lie. Just very difficult to judge how we'll come out of this rough. Difficult angle coming into this pin from the right side as well. 176 to this hole location.
The left portion of the green is pretty crowned. It's kind of a false front on the, and then a false back. The right portion where this hole is flatter. However, it does roll away from the players at the back portion as well.
And that came out a little chunky and left.
Well, Friday, June 10th. And on this date in 1950, of course, Ben Hogan, the year after the near fatal car accident, the U.S. Open here, and the one iron closed it out. Amazing. And you always got to, you come here to Merion, if you get a chance to play, I mean, you compare where your drive is to where that plaque is, and
well,
go and take a look.
You can see some of the spectators taking a peek,
yep,
as they exactly walk up the fairway. It's pretty spectacular.
Darling, next to play.
Just 147. There is a false front that Paige was talking about. This pin is cut about 15 paces beyond that false front. Really important to keep it on the right side of the screen. Wind's coming a little out of the right.
Just came out like a marshmallow. Yeah. I mean, that's the inconsistency of this rough, and that is the penalty of not finding these fairways. I mentioned the 18th hole playing difficult. In 2013, zero birdies on the weekend in the men's U.S. Open, so it certainly is a high test for the players.
Say that again. That's amazing.
Zero birdies over the weekend.
It's crazy. So the Americans one up in the match. Rachel Heck will be first.
She will. She's just 1 yard behind her partner, Rachel Keane. And with GB and I not hitting two good shots in here, they're just looking to hit something smart on the right side of the screen. They both walked up, the Americans, to see where this hole location was. Somewhat of a blind shot from down here in this valley.
Hitting just took off.
Well, in this that back portion slopes away from the players. It's very difficult to keep it in that plateau of the screen, which is why it has been so challenging
over the years. You just keep thinking of the history here every time you see a shot, Justin Rose, mm-hmm. to close
rolled
it out.
Out to the back uh-huh. edge. Perfect. Yeah. Settle.
Man.
Just part of the texture of this hole.
Not sure they realize.
Oh, left maybe? Okay, yeah. But it's an easier chip. Right, right. That's what we're putting here.
Talking about the chip, so yeah, they do.
I think
they do. Pretty cool. That walk back up to the green. Back to 60.
We stunking? Getting a little bit of help from the walking official just to make sure of things, Karen.
He is, and I've seen a fair bit of this rough, and this is as bad a lie as I have seen across the board from anybody.
I had a sense you were going there when you said I've seen enough of this rough.
Where's the ball, sir?
That this one was going to be a challenge.
I mean, Louise Duncan has a lot more clubhead speed, and she can flat out decelerate on the ball and move it. But I think this one's going to be even a challenge for her. I mean, the yardage I've got is 163 to the hole. That's not an awful lot of loft on this, and it looks like she might even be playing out to the right.
I was going to say, it wouldn't have been as big of a challenge if you didn't have to carry and strike to an uphill elevated green.
So he's actually going to go.
Yeah, she's got a pretty straightforward shot from where Heath is.
104 to that thing.
Oh, and that's not going to help. This is like window of opportunity swinging wide open for the Americans right here.
Meanwhile, at 18, from in front, Hannah Darling. Tight lie.
Very, and her and her caddy just walked up here to find a spot that they're trying to get this ball to crest and then just roll down towards this hole location. You're just really trying to get it up to the top and then let it all run away from you. She was looking a little right of this hole location, hoping it goes right to left, breaking on her.
Oh, wow.
It's a good shot. Really good.
Spectacular.
See if they can try to steal this last hole and get a half a point. Back at 16.
See what Duncan can do.
And that was crazy how tough that was.
See if she can match her partner, Fuller.
They can get two shots in here close. It puts the pressure back on the Americans, both in the rough, both having to chip.
Just checked. Had some spin. A couple of par putts. And the Americans got to keep their concentration now. They're both off the back of the green.
It was a big reaction.
It was a big opening, but
big opening at 16 for the Americans.
It's a huge opening with the British players in serious trouble. This one's a little bit out to the right, though.
Oh, Miliancho missing the green as well. How about Rose Zhang?
Well, the green is wide open for a player to hit it.
Oh, sit.
That's gone too.
A quality shot right at it.
It might have been a touch of a pull, too. I would have been shocked if she went right at that hole location, which explains why it went a little bit long. So still not perfect with her ball striking.
Rachel X third on the way, 18. That's all they needed.
She knew it.
It's what they needed. Looking around for a concession. And going to get it. So closing out this match. It goes all the way to 18.
Let's go! Let's go, guys. Come on. Really great. Thank you. Awesome.
Thank you.
Happy birthday for sure, Rachel Keane turning 21 years of age today, along with partner Rachel Heck. Put another point on the board.
Good job. Thank you.
So the U.S. with 2 points on the board, and that match number three, the only match on the golf course here in the opening four-ball session of the 42nd edition of the Curtis Cup. Remember, it's GB and I with the big lead after day one the last time around in Wales. It was 4.5 to 1.5, and then back came the Americans, eventually won by 5 points in the end. But it's the tone has been set by the Americans so far.
Hi! Thank you for watching. Thank you. You got your pins, your tattoos. Look, I got my bracelet still.
Yeah.
Let's go figure out what we're doing next. Once you get some food is about
inspiring the next.
Oh, thank you so much.
Teammates watching. Yeah. From just off the green. Got a moment? Send it down to Julia.
Hi guys, congratulations on the first point on the board today. How excited were you to go out in the first match today, really set the momentum for your team?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was really exciting. I love getting to play with Rachel, and it's our first time getting paired together in Curtis Cup, so we were just excited, and obviously Hannah and Annabelle are great players, and we knew that going in. We knew it would be a tough match, and I think we were both glad to pull it out.
Rachel, what were your nerves like over that last chip? Did you know what the moment was? Were you excited for it?
Yeah, I mean, that's the beauty of team golf, because the nerves weren't too bad because Rachel had a chip, but I have so much trust in her game that she that I know I can just swing freely, chip freely, and
awesome. Yeah, it's fun.
How exciting was it to get sung happy birthday today on the first tee?
Not really a birthday person, but I got really excited when I saw the dates of Curtis Cup, and hoped I would make the team, but to spend it with them and have all my friends and family all in one place, it's incredible, and getting sung on the first tee was something I'll remember for a long time.
Well, congratulations, guys. Good luck this afternoon. Back to you, Berko.
Julia, thanks. Team Rachel, point on the board for the Americans. We go out to 16. Karen, give us an update.
Well, there's a whole lot going on. Amelia's going to be next with her chip. She's already on the way. I mean, everybody else is just in trouble. Louise played her shot up to the left side of the green. She's got a chip for a par. And Charlotte Heath, she has a shot, but she's so far left of the green, it's going to be really difficult to get it close. Roseanne, with her short game ability, should have a good opportunity to get up and down, but from this rough, it's very much all up in the air still.
About 45 minutes ago, you thought Great Britain and Ireland had a chance to maybe get a point and a half in the morning session, and now in danger of losing their only lead with the remaining match on the course, Karen. It changes quickly.
It does, and the one thing I would say is that that was just a tough lie Heath had there. On the previous hole, Heath had a putt to go two up, and it always makes my stomach turn when you see a player miss an opportunity like that, because normally, having played in and seen a number of Solheim Cups and Curtis Cups that when something like that happens, it normally kind of energizes the other side to give them an opportunity, because all of a sudden you think, oh, we dodged one there, we're still in this, we can still keep going. So if you have those chances, you really should make them. It's easier said than done, because under the pressure and the circumstances, but it just keeps that door open.
Zhang now from over the green.
Thick lie, but still possible.
Settle.
Oh, that's big.
That's gone.
Yep.
You know, the challenge of these delicate shots with the thick rough is you've got to keep the speed up to get the club through it, but then it could just explode off the club face. And Karen getting worse by the minute.
Well, she's gone down that big slope now at the front of the green, and she might still be away. In fact, I think she's still away. I mean, it's amazing when you think of the trouble that Louise Duncan's been in. She could come off here with a five, might even chip it in. And it's crazy the swings and roundabouts that you see in match play.
Yeah, Rose Zhang was, what, 15, 18, 20 feet from the hole with her third. Now she's got two, three times as much for her fourth.
The mistake was both American players not hitting this green. I mean, 100%. They had the opportunity, Paige. If one of them has to hit the green.
And really, after Amelia missed it, the onus was on Rose. And it just, what have you seen from her today, Karen? Because it just, from our appearances, it's just been a little bit off.
It has. We've seen some fat shots, some fat approaches. We've seen some thin approaches. Generally speaking, the trajectory has not been quite right. My personal feeling is that she's struggling with the lies on this golf course, whether it's sort of uphill, downhill, ball above your feet. I think some of the time she's been in a little bit confused as to where contact is with the ground on those shots.
Rose for par.
Big shoulder turn on that one, trying to get up that steep slope.
Not bad, but not done. Each young woman so talented, handling the moment. How about mom, Brenda Corey Keene, birthday hug for her daughter, Rachel, turning 21 years young today. Brenda and Rachel, one of the two mother-daughter combos to ever participate in the Curtis Cup. Jane and Kelly Booth, now the Keens, and go back 21 years ago, U.S. Women's Open at Pine Needles. Brenda playing, 8 months pregnant with Rachel. She said she, in fact, felt a contraction after a tee shot on the 11th hole. Less than a couple weeks later, Rachel was born. Now Heath.
This is one of those ones that, you know, you're just trying to get the speed right, just to kind of put it in there close around the hole. Amelia does have a putt that's in there about 8 feet away from the hole, maybe a little less than that. So you kind of always want to expect your opponent to make it, but I think if you're GB and I, you're kind of hoping that she doesn't. And that's going to leave a testy one. And Louise is not on the green yet, although she does have a putter out, Paige, here.
They've had so much trouble with the speed, Karen. I hate to look too far ahead, but I'm thinking about foursomes matches and how difficult these greens have played.
I think, though, foursomes, what you find is that players have a much more conservative strategy. Mm. So they play a little bit, you know, not taking on too much, and especially with the putting. It'd be interesting to see how they put the pairings together and who plays with who. I always think with foursomes you want players that have very similar games to be paired together, because you need to know that wherever you leave them, they're going to be comfortable playing from.
Duncan for her four.
This would be incredible.
You've got to pay it a little bit off your back foot here, Paige, because of the slope and the thick grass there. Easy. That was nice.
Not bad.
They've all sort of hit the wall on this hole, Karen. In some way, shape, or form.
Marion will catch up with you.
What'd you say the last six holes were? Tragedy?
Isn't that
what you said?
That is what the lore around this club is, yes.
Well, when you think about it, Justin Rose won the 2013 US Open, and he was 8 over par for these last four holes. 8 over par and you win the US Open the last few holes.
It's incredible.
It's crazy how, you know, obviously that's the 4-day total, but that's still a lot. That just shows you just how difficult these last few holes are. And you kind of have the impression that when you're playing matches, you've just got to keep hanging in there, hanging in there, hanging in there until these last few holes, and then you think to yourself, I'll just make pars and I'm good.
Emiliano for her par to win the hole and tie the match.
Of the two American players, Steve, Amelia's been the more solid on the greens. And if I was Team USA, I think this is the player that I would have won with this putt.
In bogey putts coming up all around.
This is hard fought. I mean, this is, you know, it's almost, is this hole ever going to end?
Let's hope so.
And that's why you can mentally have to always stay in it. It's these days and these matches can be such a mental grind.
And it's only Friday morning, or now early afternoon,
sure.
But first session. Heath up first.
And I would say that these whole locations have been really very difficult for a morning's first time, first round of this competition.
Welcome to Merion.
I suppose show me an easy hole location on these greens then. Quick stroke.
Blasted, yep.
That's what I'm saying, Paige. When you're putting on these greens, that you need a patience to it. There's no way to force the putts in the hole. You cannot think, I've got to make it, so I'm going to hit it firmer and jam it in there. You can't do that.
No, and I think it's experience in playing in quick greens as well as kind of learning what you have to do to ensure a two putt.
Zhang up next for her bogey.
Find on downhill putts, making a nice slow stroke is a little bit easier to hit with the right pace. Well done.
There's world number one.
So Emiliano able to pick up her mark. But still a chance for GB and I to somehow tie this hole.
And of the two, this is the most unlikely one that I would have
thought.
Isn't
that the truth?
I mean, seriously, Paige, I mean, for Louise Duncan to barely be able to move her golf ball with the second shot, I mean, I'm shaking my head out here because that was just a terrible lie. But
and very significant in this match.
If she can make this putt, they've really escaped. Yep.
Brilliant. Houdini.
Great Britain Island 5, United States of America 5, Great Britain Island 1 up.
So after the adventure that was the 16th hole, 1 up, 2 to play. GB and I trying to get a point on the board here. 2 points on the board already for the U.S. And they head over to 17, the par 3. 189 yards. Before you make that turn, come back up the hill, down the hill, then up the hill to the clubhouse.
Get a sense. It is an elevated tee box playing 6 yards downhill. But Karen, not an easy hole location today.
No, and you don't want to go left either. I mean, if there's any place that you think you might, if you're going to miss it, you want to be a little bit to the right side, if anything. Left this flags, no good. So many undulations on this hot green, too. It's massive. It looks like a huge target sitting out there in the distance, but you know that your margins for error are very small.
Yeah, there's a bowl in the front portion of this green. Like I said, not a lot of true distinct tiers, a lot of mounding in these greens, but the 16th hole and the 17th hole, you can see that big bowl in the front. And that back portion of the green actually slopes away from the players as well. So the plateau, again, that these players are shooting for, that's pretty darn narrow.
Lead since 13.
Well, then it's vital that for the GBNI team that this team get a win here. This one looks good.
Wow!
Really good.
Wow!
Best we've seen so far.
That's stepping up.
Only four paces between the top of that ridge and where that hole location is. There could not have been a much better place to land it.
Well, no, and it's a nice spot to be now, Louise Duncan, knowing that your partner is up there sitting pretty. And I think this GB and I team have played this the right way, with Louise being the longer, a little bit more wild player playing second. This is a really high shot. It's got caught a little bit of wind there, though. Yeah, just got a little gust of wind.
It's going to stay. Yes. I think. No. Yes. No. Yes. Yeah, kind
yes,
of.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. A lot of pressure on the Americans now. Can't lose this hole.
I'd like to see Rose put an aggressive swing on this. I think she's been just a little bit soft with her swings, just trying to place shots as opposed to just swinging and playing. I think she's trying to be too perfect, Paige.
Well, that's easy to do in this game.
All been there. This one is drawing. It's got to hang in there a little bit. Oh.
What'd you say about the left side, Carrie?
It's not good. Mm. It's quick. It's really quick, the chip from there. And the grass is so thick and lush.
So more than ever, Miliancho really needing a good tee shot.
So again, we're seeing Rose go on the par three, missing the green, and making the pressure be on Emilio. So I think it's really hard for Rose to be the player, to kind of be a little bit passive, go for the middle of the green, don't go for the hero shot. That's a low strike, but it's slightly left, but it's going to be very functional. That'll do nicely. Good job, Amelia.
Might have to make it, though.
Yep. It is that time of the match, and what a way for Great Britain and Ireland to step up. Charlotte Heath with the shot of the day on 17.
Absolutely. When they needed it. I mean, to try to close it out, at least. I mean, advantage, they're one up in the match, but boy, so much pressure on the Americans now.
Well, I think it kind of goes back to Karen's comment a minute ago, saying that when you get the opportunity, go out and grab it. And for Great Britain and Ireland, they have an opportunity to close out the match here. Why wait another hole? Why play conservatively? And you've got a couple of players that were willing to be aggressive on that.
Heath, who was a sophomore this past year, Florida State. Karen knows the Seminoles a little bit, but what a shot here at 17.
189 yards in the air, and it, like I said, it plays down 5 or 6 yards, but you're still looking at over 180 yards with hybrid, and it just would never left the flagstick. I mean, it could not have been more perfect on that line and on that yardage.
A couple of feet, maybe a yard short, might come back down, but that just did carry it. And stay. So that for birdie when she gets up to the green, the 20-year-old from England. Honorable mention All-American at Florida State, ranked 59th in the amateur ranking. Australian women's amateur champion as well, as we send it down to Kay.
I'm alongside Elaine Ratcliffe, the captain of GB&I. You got to be on pins and needles right now. How important, I mean, every point's important, but how important is this last match?
We need a point on the board. We've played hard this morning. I think the middle match, unfortunately, we just didn't have we didn't have any birdies, which is obviously crucial in four ball. I think the top match could have gone either way. I just need this point at the bottom half. All four of them, again, have played good golf this morning, but we need to come out on top this morning.
What is the theme message for your team? Obviously, the U.S. has such an advantage being on home soil, and they're ahead in the average of the world amateur golf ranking stats. What is your message, and what are these players holding on to?
Really, that they're good golfers, and we're playing on a really good golf course. We have no fear on how to play this course, and I think they just want to go out and show the kind of golf that they can play. And I think that's what's important, that they go out, hit the ball where they need to. And the crucial thing is always going to be holes on putts, and that's what we've not done this morning.
Well, a good chance for GB&I to get a point on the board. Best luck.
So Elaine Ratcliffe, who was the captain the last time around, last year in Wales, that loss to the U.S., but a decorated amateur career, English women's amateur, 1998.
She has a little history with Sarah Ingram as well, as they paired up against each other in 96. GB&I came out on top in that match, as well as her and her individual.
That one taking place in Ireland. They've only won one time on U.S. soil back in 1986. Can you know her well?
I do. Elaine and I have played together as foursomes partners when we represented England. In fact, Elaine beat me when she won the English Ladies Championship, so we go back a long time. We're good friends, and it's really good to see her enjoying this role as captain.
It's Duncan from the front edge.
Big steep slope to climb up. So difficult, because you know once the ball gets to the top, it's going to want to accelerate quickly towards the hole. Such a fine line.
Yeah, there's very few good leaves around here that aren't just right next to the hole, Karen.
No, that's a good point. And even the short putts, Paige, they all have break to them. You all have to think about where the ball's going to die into the hole. Now, Rose's chip, this one is downhill, and it's so thick from over there. You need it to be a delicate shot, but you need to hit it firmly. It's such a tough thing to do.
Didn't run out.
That one cut through the rough. It cut through the rough a lot better than her previous hole, where she had a similar just off the edge of the green.
Looked like she about gave up on it. It kept going. I mean, we all did.
We saw a short while ago when Rachel Heck finished up. So many people want to see one of the very best in amateur golf. But it's the infectious personality as well. There's Rachel with young Isabel. If you know Rachel Heck.
But yours are better. I have my own non-toxic nail polish set for my friend. Oh, my birthday.
Wow. Did you do it yourself? When was your birthday?
May 10th.
That was pretty recent.
Yeah. And then my mom gave me a spa day, so I got them on my toes and nails.
Oh, I bet that was so nice.
Yeah. It took about an hour for everything.
I bet it took a long time. These look like...
That's young Isabel, who was at Westchester last year at the U.S. Women's Amateur, following around Rachel Heck. Hop in the car, drive a few hours south to Philly, and you've got a relationship for life between these two.
All the way until I leave.
Yeah, we have some in the locker.
Hey, can we just keep the mic open and listen to them while this plays take place? That's great. Miliacho, this for birdie.
Another quick one. Down the hill, breaking left.
I'm surprised that stayed out there.
She is too, I would imagine. So an opportunity for Great Britain and Ireland to close out the match. Heath with that birdie putt. Is Louise Duncan next with the par putt, though?
You would think so. And regardless whether she's away or not, I would.
Yeah.
She should go anyway. Yeah. Just to go ahead and put this away and then give Heath a free run at the birdie and the win. Elaine was right. She does need this point. But this is something that, as a Great Britain and Ireland player, you kind of expect. You expect the American team to be very strong in the four ball. But you also know your strength lies in the foursomes, which is coming up this afternoon. Players from Great Britain and Ireland tend to play foursomes much more.
And I suspect, Karen, that is why in Wales last year they led
yes.
with foursomes, whereas in the United States they've led with four ball in the format on Friday morning.
Exactly.
So this putt to win the hole and win the match. Charlotte Keith, 1 point on the board for GB and I.
Very well played.
Well played indeed. Heck and Keen, the winners of the first match, Avery Gane, kind of took control right out of the gate and kept going. 3-2 the win, and it's Duncan and Heath, 2-1 the win in the last match of the morning. Today's uninterrupted coverage of this 42nd Curtis Cup was presented by Rolex. Coming up next, it's the ShopRite LPGA Classic. We're not done from Merion, though. Come back with the afternoon foursome session, 2:30 Eastern time. You can join us over on Peacock as we bring you continuing uninterrupted coverage of the 42nd Curtis Cup presented by Rolex. So last time around, last year, it was GB and I who took the big lead early on day one. They led 4.5 to 1.5, but it's the Americans taking the lead here in the four ball morning session. 2-1. Just getting started, though. 3 days of competition here. Close it out with the singles on Sunday. 2-1 USA to open up here at Merion.